Check.
Time.
What?
Alrighty, folks, welcome back to Live in 5, episode number 15, baby. I am your co-host, DJ Swish, alongside, as always, my co-host, Gage Ausmus, brought to you always by Mini Movers and Butter Golf. Butter Golf is the official lifestyle and clothing brand over here at Live in 5, folks. It's getting close to the Christmas season, a couple weeks away, Ozzo. So if you want a last-minute Christmas, you know, a hat, a shirt, a collared shirt, whatever it is, something for, you know, the lovely. Maybe it's a brother. Maybe it's a cousin. Whoever the hell it is, go over to butter.golf. Check it out. We got some new hats coming up within the week. We have some of our older stuff. And then on the other side of 2024, a big launch here, fella, coming in. So very excited for what's to come. But right now, we got some of the older stuff, a couple newer things coming on. So go check it out. None of the Forks hats left. Those are all sold out, and especially, I believe, at the Sioux shop, there might be a couple Chelly green options left, but that's on the Butter Golf front. Ozzo, how we doing, brother? This past weekend, we were both up in Vegas of the North, I like to call it, Grand Forks, North Dakota, and it just seems to be the same song and dance every time you leave that goddamn place. I'm hurting a little today, boy. It's Monday over here, fella, so how we doing? How was the drive back yesterday, and are you still a little stung? Because the Forks always hits you right across the chin.
Definitely still a little stung. Obviously, you're trying to keep up with a couple Sasky boys on the weekend. And you know how that goes. It's a tough... You don't want to find yourself in that situation. But you know what? I'm a competitor. And I had to take them on. I had to go toe-to-toe with them. They probably won that battle. But, oh well. You know what? I got heart. I'm not afraid of anything. So... No, it's the drive home obviously is terrible. Any drive from Grand Forks to Minneapolis, especially on a Sunday, is never fun. I'm glad that it's over. I'm just looking forward to, you know, this Christmas season where I can relax a little bit, spend some time with the family, you know, eat some food. I've also been doing this carnivore diet thing, so I've been trying to stick with that as much as I can, trying to get a little lighter as we head into holiday season. Where all the cookies and shit will come out. So,
also, what does that consist of? Just going straight meat wagon with it, limiting the carbs, obviously staying away from deep fried foods, probably not heading to Chili's for the queso. Is that just something you've built into the regimen over the last couple of weeks, or you've been going low and slow with this for a little bit now?
Yeah, no, this is, I'm coming up on this will be week three. I'm a little over, yeah, so week three doing it. And it's been good. I've lost some weight. I actually feel great. I'm walking around. I feel light. So, you know, it's not actually as hard as I thought it would be. You know, usually when you're hungry, you kind of crave something, and whatever it is, pasta, you know, fries, potatoes, whatever, carbs. But as soon as you eat the meat, you know, you're not hungry anymore. So you're not craving it. So all you gotta do is just, you know, have the discipline to eat the meat and then let it kind of settle. And, you know, once you're full, it's over. It's not that hard. So it's kind of the initial, you know, getting past the, oh, I kind of crave, you know, this taste in my mouth. Once you get over that and you just learn that you need to eat the meat and then let it settle, it's pretty easy after that because you're not hungry anymore and you're not craving anything. So, yeah, I don't know why I'm doing it, sure. Honestly. I just wanted to challenge myself. That's it.
100%. Yeah. I mean, speaking like a couple dietitians over here, I've been doing probably for the last 3 to 4 months is intermittent fasting where you eat your meal. You're probably the first one of the day, somewhere in between noon and 3 p.m. And you kind of have this window of about 6 to 8 hours where you eat. So I'll do like 2 or 3 meals. Usually it's like a big lunch or a breakfast around noon, somewhere between noon and two. And then I'll have a smoothie probably around 3 or 4, maybe 5, and then a big dinner, and then don't eat the next day for, you know, 12 to 15 hours. And I actually feel really good. I feel like most mornings I get my workouts in, and then the rest of the day I'm just drinking coffee and water until I get on the other side of noon. I feel pretty good, man. Light, it tightens you up, you know. Speaking, so It's just funny you're doing that. You know, we're a couple of dietitians, a couple of guys trying, you know, a few different things over here at Live and Five, yeah. Talking like just on the side of our ass. But you go back to Forks, Ozzo, Friday night, man, aside from the game, it just reminded you, especially me, I hadn't been up there in the wintertime for 8-9 years now. And mm-hmm. it's just funny. I fly in on Thursday night. It was pretty good weather. Actually, really nice. It was about 50 degrees when I landed about midnight on Thursday. And Friday, though, it brought you right back to what the Forks actually is. And how many inches of snow did it end up being? Because that shit was throwing both ways. The wind was howling at 20 miles an hour. And in December, that's what you expect in Forks. So I kind of sneakily liked it, but it made for some travel, you know, shit shows and things like that for Sunday. But, it was great being back there. And you touched on the Sasky guys as well. Just so funny. So shout out to Colton Sanderson, who's a buddy, obviously a dear friend over here at Live and Five. One of our best friends, he has these guys in for moose jaw. And for the folks that know Canadians, in particular Western Canadians, the viewers and the listeners here, those guys are just a different breed. Also, they're from the cornfields or from the prairies. They just, even their lingo, when I'm listening to these guys, I'm so just drawn in by the words they're saying, the lingo. So I should always have like a notepad or a piece of paper and a pen, because some of the things 100%. Come out of my mouth are like, you only learn these things like in a small town bar or sitting at the rink. So Rico, Uncle Rico, as we like to call him, Colton Sanderson, has these two guys in town. And on Saturday night, after kind of my work shift was done and you guys were at the game watching, obviously, we were at Hot Stovin' and over at Harry's, which is an establishment in Grand Forks. It's the best steakhouse in town. I get over there after doing a little shindig meal service with my family, Jake, obviously my cousin and uncle and aunt and grandparents. And we're sitting there just chopping up, telling old war stories, hanging out, you know, a bunch of laughs, having a couple Irish coffees, whatever it was. But they started bringing up one of their buddies. And we got to shine light on this guy, Ozzy. His name is Corey Arnott. And basically, what it comes down to is just giving love for beer league hockey and Saskatchewan beer league hockey, because these guys are a different breed. Apparently, this guy, who we both don't know, but I mean, the story had us in tears. This guy, literally, after every beer league game, is the first guy to shed his laundry. So he gets out of his gitch, his undergear, gets right in the shower, and he makes it a point to shower and stay in there to shower with every single guy on the team, and to a point where if you go in the shower with Corey, you have to know to bring him a beer in there and crack it for him, otherwise he won't drink it. So he ends up staying in there for 10 to 20 beers, and to the point where he actually, before the game last week, was in the locker room and showered with a team that just finished their game. So he did a whole shift with another team and then top team with the boys. I mean, he's walking out of that rink. I mean, you probably can stick handle home, but he's walking a 30-pack deep. I was like, how funny was that, man? Listen to these stories.
It's so good. It was unbelievable. Like these senior leagues they have up north in Canada and the beer leagues, it's just incredible. Like these guys live for that shit. And it's just, you know, that guy's just one of the boys. I mean, that's just like the definition of what it means to be one of the boys. Guy likes showering. Guy likes being with the boys so much, he just hops in the shower and makes it a point. He's in there with every single guy on the team. He's not missing a single. I mean, it's just incredible.
He's literally having a beer with every single guy, and every guy that gears down on the team knows to bring Corey a beer in the shower. Like, so at what point does that shower get cold? Because those can't be, you know, the best showers, especially in Sask and rural Sask, having beers and he's drinking Pilsner. I think that just is so funny. And that's like, that epitomizes what everything about beer league, and especially beer league in Canada, is all about. Not only are you showering with your own team, having a beer with every guy, you make it a point to go in another team's locker room, gear down, and be like, hey, boys, here's your shower guy. I'm in here. Like, that's so cool. And we were asking him, like, how's Corey's game? He's like, oh, he's terrible, but what a blue guy.
Just unbelievable in the locker room.
Oh, yeah, unbelievable in the locker room. That's where they should leave him. But I thought that was so funny. Yeah. Ozzo, that weekend, I mean, you watched obviously both nights from the suite. We were on a little bit of a different regimen this week. I didn't spend as much time as I would have liked just being up there with you beauties. But how was the – what did you think of the UND games? I just want to touch on that a little bit. us both being boots on the ground at the Ralph Engelstad Arena, aka the Palace of Pain. So tough weekend for UND, the number one team in all of college hockey for the folks that don't follow UND hockey, but they played CC, Colorado College, this weekend, ended up losing both those games in overtime. So got swept on their home soil the last series before the break here, the winter break. So just touch on the games, Ozzo. What'd you see up there? And could you see, by the way, if you were having a couple?
I actually watched most of both games. Usually, you know, up in the suites, you never know, especially when you're with a couple Sasky guys, like we said, and some of those guys up in the suites, you know, it's the best bar in North Dakota. So it gets pretty social up there, but I did enjoy watching the games. I thought Friday night, it seemed like they should have, you know, they're up 2-0. It seemed like they had the game won kind of, and they just kind of expected to win the game. CC crawls back into it and wins it in overtime there. Kind of leaving everyone shocked a little bit. So then you're coming back Saturday and you're like, well, there's no way they lose tonight, you know, like, and you know what? CC looked good. They played well. I didn't think North Dakota played terrible. I just didn't think they didn't look that much better than CC. I don't know if they actually deserved to win either of those games, which was surprising to see. But you know what? At the end of the day, it's a hell of a first half for almost a new team at North Dakota, and definitely exceeded my expectations for the first half. I just hope the boys can rein it in and, you know, come out playing for the second half. Who knows? That's a tough way to end the first half. But Jordo, I wanted to ask you, because obviously, you know, this is your debut on TV. So what's it like, you know, because you're not commentating during the game. Are you making sure to kind of be dialed into the whole game just so you are ready for those intermissions and post-game talks?
For sure. And I thought, you know, Friday night was a little bit easier to get into the flow of the game because we had the half-hour pregame show. So for people listening, I made my TV debut up on Mid-Continent Sports, which is a part of the UND Hockey, their broadcasting partnership. So it was awesome. I was basically doing, you know, the pregame show on Friday, then did some intermission stuff between the periods, and then ultimately a postgame show. So that was cool. But due to the weather and a couple other things on Saturday, there was no pregame show. So it kind of felt like I went from second or third line minutes on Friday, where you really got into the flow of things. You did the pregame show, stuff to talk about from the past weekend with Denver, and then leading up to the game, some keys for CC, some stuff for UND. And then, you know, you get into the flow of the game where you're watching in between periods and you can kind of build what the highlight package is going to be, what you're going to touch on. So that was awesome on Friday night, and then wrapped it up with the post-game show. And then Saturday, it was a little different, Ozzo. It kind of felt like I was playing fourth line minutes where you don't have as many touches. So when you're out there, the legs better be going. In this case, the voice better be going. Your questions better be dialed for the player interviews in between periods. Those little – so the reps got a little less – on Saturday. So it's funny you say that, because I felt like I was way more into the flow of the game on Friday, just with the pregame show. Saturday, it was just cut, you know, a half hour short in terms of the, not having that. So it was still awesome though. I was so pumped up to be there. I was fired up. I felt like I had good energy. I felt like I was crispy. And for a debut, for me personally, I don't think it could have went, you know, much better. I think they did a really good job of, you know, laying it all out there for me, even working with that girl named Taylor up there. She did a great job of kind of just going through the rundown, making me feel comfortable. And I think the biggest thing, Ozzo, that I would take away is you got to get used to someone talking in your ear. Not that it was a huge deal for me, but sometimes when you're, you know, mid-thought and you're kind of coming to an end of a segment, they're like, wrap it up, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then they just go. Like, so that part, I think you have to get used to a little bit of, because TV is structured. It's not like a podcast where we can just chop it up, say everything we want to say at once. Because I'm trying to work in one-liners. I'm trying to say something knowledgeable. I want to commentate on why that play happened and what caused that goal. So all in all, though, bro, like, I had a great time. I had some pretty good feedback, I think. I just can't wait for my next opportunity, whether it's with Midco or someone else. But at least now I got some game film out there, right? And I you know, throw it on my socials or send it to people, and we'll see where it goes. Cause I had a lot of fun, man. Like, it, I got that high of, like, after a game, after a big win, you know, when we were playing. So that's something I've been chasing for, you know, this last 6-7 months, and I get a little bit here with the podcast, but that TV was next level because it's live reps and you have a couple different avenues of a thought and you just go with it. So it was really cool.
Yeah, I thought you nailed it. I thought, you know, for especially for a first time, no one could tell that was your first time, I don't think. You know, if you were watching you, there's no way someone could tell that was your first time. I was, you know, I love the outfits. First night, classic gray, black tie, white shirt, and then your second day, the Saturday sports coat. That was nails. That was a good look. You had the hair slicked back. You look good up there, man. You had some of your classic lines there, talking about the goals. You know where grandma hides the cookies. You were quick with it. Were you writing? Did you know that's kind of what you're gonna say before? Like you have this stuff written down at all, or is that just kind of off the top of your head?
Yeah, I would say more so just off the top of my head. I mean, you know me, Ozzo. I have a bag of one-liners that I kind of just pull out in certain situations, and I'm definitely thinking about it in my head what I can use. Like the one night on Saturday where that Logan Will ended up scoring his second goal, where he kind of whiffed on it and then got it back again. I was like, okay, 2-for-1. What am I thinking? What can be funny? Like, what do people know in Grand Forks? What do people know? What the department store people know? I don't know if they really know Joseph A. Bank. I wanted to use that for like the soup company, but I'm like, okay, they know J.C. Penney. So I'm like, fuck, Logan Will, you know, 2-for-1 special, like a J.C. Penney suit sale, right? Something like that. So I was trying to incorporate different terminology. And then the one line where Garrett Pike scored a goal in the same game, it was a muffin. It was just a shot that was maybe clocking in at like 34 miles per hour, but it got through the first layer of traffic. It got to the net, and there was bodies there. So then I was like, wow, okay. Well, as you know, when we were at North Dakota, our assistant coach, Dane Jackson, loved the line muffins count. So I incorporated that. I was like, you know, it's not how. They don't ask how. They ask how many. And as our coach that I played for at UND, Dane Jackson, would always tell us, muffins count. So I used that line on that goal. and just different things to work in, where grandma hides the cookies. Cheddar is always better. Yeah. Keeping it like PG at the same time, right? Because I think that's important, where you're, you know, curious, knowledgeable, but you also have to be yourself and be funny. So that's what I really wanted to incorporate. And hey, for a first rip, I thought it was cool. I thought it was awesome. Obviously, I can get better. I think there was a couple of times where, not fumble fucking, but I think I could be quicker, you know, just different things. Maybe I mispronounced the word, but we can't all be perfect, baby. I just was having a hell of a time up there.
I was expecting you to say Saturday was easier. So I didn't expect that part, because I would have thought, you know, Friday, first time doing it, like, holy shit, you got the jitters. You're a little scared. You know, you got the butterflies. But then Saturday, you're just like, I've already done this before. So that was kind of interesting to hear you say that. You know, you just couldn't find the rhythm. And yeah, I mean, it's hilarious you relate it to the fourth line minutes. You know, when you're on the fourth line, you're not getting many shifts. Those shifts are so much harder than when you are getting normal shifts. Yes. You know, it's just, it's tough. You can't get in the flow.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I just thought I was more comfortable Saturday, and I felt like I had to be more dialed in. I think the more you're talking, as you know, or the more you're playing, the more comfortable you're with it. You're riding that wave. You're in flow state. So the minutes I was getting kind of shrank on Saturday. And I was like, okay, well, I better be dialed in, because I got to play a really good game with less reps. And that's what I really tried to focus on. So I thought that part almost made me dial in more, which wasn't creating nerves. I was just like, I got to be good here. So yeah, it was cool. I ultimately, also, I would love to call a game, work my way into color commentating or, you know, broadcasting, whatever it is in terms of play by play. So it was cool, man. I just want to say thank you to all the good folks at Midco. That was awesome. Tip of the cap. And if you need me, like I told Alex, hey, fella, I'm like a David Ayers over here, emergency backup. So I will be ready on a bird, heading up to the Forks whenever you need me. But let's get to some NHL chop. Ozzo, let's start at the top here. One of the biggest stories in hockey right now. Thank God he's okay. The MRI came back negative. I don't know if he had a CT scanner. I'm not a doctor over here. I just know a few of them. So Dylan Larkin, the incident with Matthew Joseph and Parker Kelly. He was cross-checked, I believe, on the side of the head, and then kind of went into Kelly in a forward motion. He kind of gave him a little bit of a shot, and then ultimately dropped to the ice, was knocked unconscious. It was a scrum play in front of the net, and it just sucks to see, because Larkin has dealt with neck and head injuries in the past, especially with the neck injury from Jamie Benn, you know, 7-8 months, and he's had a couple concussions as well. So never a good sign when you see your captain with his chin on the ice, just laying there motionless. What did you think of the overall play, though, in terms of Joseph? What's the suspension looking like that? Does Chelly get, you know, some supplementary discipline? Or how do you really cut that up? Because that was a tough play.
It was tough, and it makes it a little weirder because, you know, I don't know how long ago this was, but those two have history, right? Joseph and Larkin. I think Joseph kind of hit him from behind one game a while back, and Larkin just suckied him, you know, with his glove on. About 2 years ago. So there's a little history there. And then, you know, I see Joseph's, I see his interview after the game, you know, yeah, it was a tough call. You know, I just looked around or battling for a puck. You know, I didn't really know what happened. You know, I didn't even know I hit him in the face. And I'm hearing him say that, and I'm like, you didn't know you cross-checked him in the face? I mean, I don't know about that. I didn't think he, like, it didn't look like it was, like, blatant. I think, honestly, David Perron might get the worst of this because he actually goes after the wrong guy. He just completely dummies his Zub or Zeb or whatever. Just, guy didn't even do
anything. Yeah, Artem's up. Cripples him. I had that written down. How funny was that? He came off the top rope and just absolutely cross-checked him like a jumping cross-check. He didn't even get the right guy.
It was so awesome. By Perron. So nails. He didn't even know who did it. He just turns around. First guys he sees, he's like, you're fucking dead. This Superman cross-check to the face. Unbelievable.
That was an amazing play. And DP, a guy I played with, like, he's a tough Frenchman. Like, you don't mess with him, especially with his stick. That's exactly something DP would do. And being the teammate that I know he is he sees his captain on the ice, motionless, unconscious. He's like, fuck. I got to do something. I got to take an eye for an eye here. Oh, yeah. And that jumping cross check. I mean, it's not funny. I hope Zub's okay. But it was kind of funny that he just jumped and just absolutely dummied him. Yeah. And then when he dropped to the ice, when Zub dropped, he still got on top of him. It's like, dude.
Oh, yeah. He's like, you're going to pay, buddy. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was, yeah, I mean, it's not funny, like you said, but it's always funny when you got a guy, you know, he didn't see what happened, but he just sees one of his guys on the ice, and he's like, all right, someone's getting it.
Someone's dead. And just to go back to the Larkin play, I'm with you, Ozzy. I don't think he's trying to do what ultimately happened. I think he's trying to get him with a cross check, maybe somewhere up high. I don't know if he's trying to get him in the face or the neck. It looked like he got him, like, somewhere between the neck and the temple, and he just dropped and, you know, just tagged his chin ultimately, and that's the reason why he was, you know, knocked out on the play. But it's tough. It didn't seem like Joseph was all that sorry for it, though. And
no,
it didn't seem that he – right. So that, the part, you know, most of the time you're like, okay, if you do something like that, you feel bad about it. You're like, oh, my God, I'm so sorry, this and this. You have a, you know, a terrible – that's on me. But it just didn't seem the message he sent was he was all that – you know, worried or concerned for Larkin. And maybe that goes back to the history they had where, again, the same kind of thing. He ran him from behind 2 years ago. Larkin had a history with the head and neck, and, you know, he put him in the danger zone a couple of years ago. Larkin gets up and gives him the Red Rover forearm shiver, which I don't mind for a guy that is worried about his body, but it just seems like this is kind of the same area he targeted. And whether he did it on purpose, you know, intentionally or unintentionally, I don't love the play. And it seems to me that that should be at least a couple game suspension, maybe one or two. But David Perron, I think you could probably got to give him, as much as I love that guy, Davey White Boots, wear the white Reeboks all throughout his career. Now wears the white True Skates. I think he's got to get at least two or three games because you can't do that, man.
You can't.
That was crazy. No, so hopefully Larkin's okay. The screening came back negative. I believe he's on the injured reserve just in terms of the head injury. So hope the captain's doing well. They need him in Detroit, especially what they're building there. Kyle Connor hit last night, I believe the other night, Ozzy. Ryan Strome, kind of a weird play. Just one of those where you catch a guy in the tracks and you're trying to make body contact with him. You grab the knee on knee. He goes down. He's going to miss some time. But the funny part about this situation was Stromer immediately knows that he's probably going to have to fight someone. Kyle Connor, one of their better players, if not their best player on the Winnipeg Jets, goes down. He's the guy to take him out. You know, it looked like a tough knee injury. So Stromer hits him. He starts looking around. Mark Scheifele ultimately grabs him and says, okay, let's dance, and gets pumped by Strom. I mean, he fed him. It was an even tilt at the start. They were kind of going toe-to-toe. They were actually, for a couple skill guys out of the Ontario Hockey League, were throwing bombs, and Strom caught him with two and dropped his ass. That was just – I wanted to ask you, it's just – again, it's not funny, but it is kind of funny when a guy gets hurt. And yes, you have to stand up for him, especially one of your better players, a knee on knee situation. But you get pumped. Like, does that really do anything after? I mean, I guess you go into a fight not knowing what was going to happen. I mean, that's why you fight, right? Who knows? You take it on. But it was just like, oh my God, like that's a tough look when you go there and just get pumpernickled.
It's the worst. It's, well, it, like you said, it's we're not laughing at an injury here, but it's just funny, you know, when, you know, you kind of want the guy who injures a guy to get beat up because he kind of deserves it for injuring someone, especially if you're a Winnipeg Jets fan. You know, you're the Winnipeg Jets. You don't expect to have a good team this year. I don't think anyone's expecting them to be good. They're in first in the Central right now on the Western side of things. They've got a good team. Kyle Connor is their best player. I mean, he's having an unbelievable season. Now he's going to be out. It's funny to think, like, does Stromer walk around? And, like, if he's in Winnipeg, I mean, there's got to be fans in Winnipeg who are like, I'm going to fucking kill this guy if I see him. Like, I mean, the fans got to be pissed at him. Does Stromer walk around, like, a little scared? Like, fuck, like, I just injured their best player. Their season's probably in jeopardy right now with how long this guy is going to be out. It's all because of me. Like, am I actually going out in Winnipeg when we go there next? I think I'm, like, ordering room service to the room.
Yeah, you might be dusting off a bottle of red, staying at the old Fairmont, keeping it high and tight. You're not going to Earl's on Main. You're not going over to the Shark Club. And you're most certainly not going to the 414 Club or the Pint, some of these bars. Because, yeah, if you're Strom, a guy that doesn't have a history of being a dirty player at all. He's a skilled guy. But that's just a tough play. And it's kind of funny that he ended up pumping Scheifele. I mean, they're both the same age as me, Ozzy. They're both 1993s. I would say Scheifele has the edge on just being the bigger player and probably, you know, taller and edges out in that way. But Strom stood in there. I think he's sneaky kind of tough. I over the years, I think he's learned to fight, as crazy as that sounds. But he's a guy that I've watched over the years. He's had his way in a couple matches in terms of drop the mitts. So, yeah, hopefully Kyle Connor is okay, Ozzy. Let's slide it over out east to a team that is old. They look slow. They look like they have no prospects. I know they don't have any prospects in their system. I actually talked to one of their player development guys today on the phone for a good while. That does a lot of work in Wilkes-Barre. Talking about the Pittsburgh Penguins. So Kyle Dubas came out and during a press conference and stated that Mike Sullivan's job is safe. He's going to be okay. He will at least make it through the season. This is our coach. But when you look at a team like Pittsburgh and they are struggling out of the gates, besides the fact that 87 Sid Crosby looks like he's 28 years old. What a sicko he is. He's still unbelievable.
Yeah.
But this team, I mean, they have a four future Hall of Famers on it. And I just feel like they're in such a weird spot with this team where they're in a win now mode because they feel like they owe it to these guys in terms of Malkin, Crosby, Letang, Eric Carlson, even a guy like Jeff Carter. But they're old, man, and they have no prospects. They don't have anything in the system, really. And as far as their younger players on the roster, they don't have a whole lot of that either. I mean, their youngest good player, I would say, would be like a P.O. Joseph, who's an okay defenseman. They have Gensel, who's getting a little bit older now, is a 1994 born player. So to me, it seems like they're in such a weird spot in Pittsburgh. They go out this summer, they get Eric Carlson. Was that the right move? Well, yeah, on paper it is. He's at 100 points, but he's not a guy that you're going to win with as your number one defenseman come April, May, and June, because I just don't think he plays that great of defense. It's, and at playoff time, as you know, it's not about putting up all the points. It's about how heavy you can play in your own end. And that to me is just, they're just in a weird spot, and I wanted you to touch on their team. And to me, it just seems like they want this team to be so good because they owe it to their older players, and they feel like they're still in a win now window. But in reality, they're pretty far away, man.
They are. I thought they were, you know, when you got these old teams, sometimes the star players are the ones who are older and they don't really perform, which is what sucks about the Penguins right now, is because Crosby and Malkin are in the, you know, they're 2 and 3 in points on the team. And then I think Eric Carlson's in the top 5. So these guys are all actually, they're old, but they're playing. They're just not getting any help from these younger guys, these role guys who are supposed to be, you know, the energy on the team. And they're just not deep enough. Those guys aren't playing to what they thought they would be. And yeah, I mean, unfortunately, I mean, right now it surely seems that, you know, this is just another season wasted with this core group, which sucks because it's probably one of their last that we'll ever get to watch.
100%. It just seems they're kind of in the same boat as a team like Washington.
Yeah,
they just 100%. Don't have the younger players stepping in and coming through the ranks of their system and getting the draft picks they need and striking on a second round pick that ultimately ends up being like a top 10 guy. He performs higher than what he was drafted. So those teams just seem to be in a weird spot. And Pittsburgh, you need your younger players driving this ship. You see it with teams even like in basketball with a guy like LeBron James. I kind of compare him to Sidney Crosby. Like, these guys are 37 to 39 years old. They can be your best player, but you need the young legs. You need the up-and-coming guys. You need guys that can win you a stretch of games to take the load off the older player, because when the older player gets to April, May, if he's, you know, spent all of his energy just getting this team into the playoffs, well, they're going to be burnt out. I mean, Father Time, Ozzy, is undefeated. So it'll be curious, or I'll be curious to see what Kyle Dubas does with that team. I think he's a sharp hockey mind. I think Mike Sullivan obviously has the pedigree. He's won a couple mugs, but they're in a weird
what
spot.
Can he do? What can he do? Out of the gates. Yeah.
Even if you traded, say, Carlson or Malkin, the return isn't going to be what you want on those guys.
No,
I mean, they're depreciating assets as is. And you're not going to be able to move a guy like Malkin, even making 6 and a hook for a couple more years. You know, you're going to have to retain some salary. And do you get draft picks for that? Are you able to get a younger player? Like, nobody's given up younger players, especially at a cheaper option. So I'm curious to see what they even do with Guentzel. Do they re-sign him to a big deal? Do they look at maybe dishing him? That's a guy that would have some value to maybe bring on some draft picks or younger players. But again, now you're parting ways with a sure 40 goal scorer and a guy that Sidney Crosby loves to play with. Now, is that really worth it? I don't know. He's not the problem, but at the same time, you got to make moves. So that team is an interesting one. We'll see what they do. Sliding across the state just to the east, one of their biggest rivals, the Philadelphia Flyers. They look great, Ozzy, on the other hand, and they're pretty much in the exact opposite, you know, spectrum of what the Penguins are right now. And I wanted to ask you, is John Tortorella the right man for a rebuild in Philly? Like, Keith Jones came out alongside Danny Breer and said, we're not going to be rebuilding. But at the same time, like, you don't want to be too good, because now you're going to get a pick anywhere from, say, 12 to 20. Because they actually might slide in the playoffs. They're in a wild card spot right now. Like, I don't know if that's the recipe for the Philadelphia Flyers at this moment, if I'm on the outside looking in.
Yeah, no, when you go up and down the roster, it's like, how are these guys good? I mean, you got a guy like Sean Couturier. He hasn't played in a while. What's his story? Like, he was nails back in the, I mean, what, 2-3 years ago, maybe 4? I mean, what's his story? Like, was he injured for a while? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he was injured for almost 2 or 3 years. He had a knee injury, and then he's had 2 or 3 operations on his back. So he was mangled, and he's finally getting back healthy. Oh. And he's been playing this year, but yes, he's been out for a while because of this back, you know, issue that he's had for an extended period of time. So he's finally back in the mix. He looks okay. I think it's going to take him a long time to get up to speed. He's never been like the fleetest of foot guy, but he's playing 20 minutes a night for them now. Their roster is hilarious, though. Like,
they're not
just
good.
Like a direct result.
Yeah.
No, like, but they play their ass off. Like, I talked to guys on the Coyotes and my brother the other week, and they played him. He's like, these guys are insane in the D zone. Like, they just battle. Like, Nick Seeler, Delorier.
Oh.
Like, these guys are just muckers.
Yeah. Yeah. And you ask about Torts. You ask about Torts on this team. Isn't it funny with Torts? Like, some teams, people are like, this guy's a fucking wizard. He's got him going. And then on other teams he's coaching, they're like, he's the reason they suck. None of the players like him. They hate him. You know, it's just like, you hear so many, like, conflicting opinions and views on this guy. Like, what is it? Who is he? He's like, is it just that Does it matter that much? Like, I mean, is he kind of like a, you know, Dave Hackstall in, at UND when we were there, when, you know, Hack was a really good coach with an average lineup because he just gets the best out of everyone. But then maybe some of the star players don't like that type of coaching. I don't know. But yeah, I mean, Torts is just an interesting cat because it seems like, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you made a great point there with, I think a guy like John Tortorella does better with a group that is expected not to do as well or not to be at the top of the standings versus having a team with higher expectations that doesn't live up to him. Because you look at his success, he had success in Tampa Bay. He had great players there, but don't get me wrong. It was a Tampa Bay Lightning. Mm-hmm. He willed those guys into it. They had Martin St. Louis, Vinny LeCavier, a lot of great players there. Dave Andrechuk, veteran leadership. So he got his mug then. But if you look at his time, I just go back to his time in Columbus. Like, the expectations were so low. They ended up beating Tampa Bay, who had the best record of all time until the Boston Bruins last year ever in the NHL, and they beat them in a playoff series. So I think Tortorella, in terms of what he's best at, I think he's best at galvanizing a group that isn't expected or doesn't have that much pressure on them, and they all buy into what he's preaching. And then from there, they'll run through a wall for this guy. And when he sees they'll run through a wall for him, he rewards them with probably days off, you know, pumping their tires. You've even seen clips come out of interviews with him and saying, this team has balls, and really, you know, pumping these guys up to a point where they're willing to do whatever for Torts. And I think that's when he's at his best. So I don't know in terms of, yes, I think he's the right man for this team. But at the same time, if you're Keith Jones and Danny Breer, like, well, we're not going to be buyers at the deadline one way or the other. I mean, we're not a cup contending team, whether we slide in or not.
Yeah.
It's just not the makeup of our group. So what do we do come the deadline? Do we sell off a guy like John Walker, who's been playing really well? A team would easily take Nick Seeler at playoff time. What do you do if you're that team? Because I just think it's like a confusing time where it's like, you want to be good. You want to have wheels in motion. You want to show your young guys what it takes to win. But at the same time, we still need to build our, you know, arsenal of picks and you know, move in a better direction in terms of getting back to signing and attracting free agents. I just think it's a weird time in Philadelphia. And if I was Keith Jones or Danny Breer, I'm looking like, well, let's be good, but we still want a chance at that, you know, to pick inside the top 10.
Yeah. You can't completely, I mean, if you're in playoff spot, you can't completely abandon the fans and even the guys on the team that year. I mean, I'm sure the guys on the team want to make playoffs. Like, how do you make that decision? That's so tough, man. I mean, I'm glad I don't have to make that decision.
Yeah, and I think it's the right guys at the helm there. Keith Jones, I think everything I've heard by all accounts, is a great guy. Danny Breer, a very smart guy. Obviously a very smart player when he played, heady, skilled guy. So it's cool to see, though. I think when, like Detroit, some of these original six teams, yes, Philly's not an original six team, but when they are good, the league just reaps the benefits. You want a team like the Philadelphia Flyers being relevant. That's just a great franchise, and I think they're getting back to the old school Philly days of when they had Ed Schneider at the, you know, running that team versus Comcast. So I think Keith Jones is really instilling, you know, that old school Philadelphia Flyer way, what it means to be a Flyer, be proud to be a Flyer, and then that recruits or gets guys, you know, attention throughout the league. Like, wow, I would sign there as a free agent because they're back. So another guy I just want to give a shout out to quick, Ozzy, before we move on to our NFL talk, Travis Sanheim, good Western Canadian, Elkhorn, Manitoba, a big reason why the Philadelphia Flyers are playing so well. They moved on from Ivan Provorov this past summer, trading him to the Columbus Blue Jackets. So this fella, 20 points in 27 games, playoffs, rebuild, what direction the Flyers going? We'll keep an eye on that, but let's send it over to our NFL Week 14 predictions. We had our picks. So we'll start with the picks. My team this week, the Green Bay Packers visiting the New York Football Giants. We are recording just minutes before kickoff over here. So we'll keep an eye on that. The final line on that was -5.5 for Green Bay. I think they get it done this week. Ozzy, who'd you have for your Week 14 pick this past week?
Buck, I had the embarrassing Philadelphia Eagles. I thought the boys were going to take a shit and, you know, lose in that big Sunday night game. They showed up, man. They're a real contender. You know, early on in the season, it was like, oh, the AFC's tough, the NFC sucks. It's completely flip-flop now. And you look at the team you just picked, and your hometown team, the Green Bay Packers. Are they top five NFC team right now? Especially if they win this game, they're fucking rolling. I don't know. This the NFL season's shaping out to be pretty entertaining here, coming up on playoff time.
Yeah, and you look at a team like the Detroit Lions. I think they're in a panic. Jared Goff, 4 picks this past week. This, you know, basically yesterday, Sunday. And Ozzy, I just wanted to ask you, dude, like, is the NFL boring now? Are you finding yourself watching as much football as you used to, or is it just a down year? I know we talked about Tom Brady's comments the other week. The NFL is just not the same as it used to be. And I've even just talked to buddies that, I mean, who are we? We're just couch potatoes on Sunday, but I am steering away from the NFL a little bit, and I wonder if that's just me and a couple guys I know, or is that a general consensus of a lot of people? Because I just think you're looking at the slate on Sundays, and you maybe, at least for me, again, I'm speaking for myself, maybe only watching one or two games, and I felt like it used to not be like that.
Yeah, no, I think it's always based off quarterbacks, and if you don't have good quarterbacks in the league, the play's not going to be great. And I think we're seeing a lot of starting quarterbacks aren't as good as they typically were with some of the older, more, you know, veteran guys we're used to seeing. And also a lot of them are injured. So the product of the NFL is way down right now because you're watching these QB2, QB3 players, you know, try to play an entire game. And it's just not even close to the same because there's so much worse than these elite quarterbacks that are out there.
Yeah, you make a good point, and that is kind of what I've been hearing too, just, you know, sitting at a bar stool, chopping up with the fellas, or even group chats. It's like, I don't know, it's just the quarterback play is not great. It sucks when guys like Joey Burrow go down and, you know, you lose them to injury, but Aaron Rodgers, it just seems like the NFL is just not as good, not as crispy rice, as I would like to say, as it used to be. And did you catch that Kansas City game last night? Did you see the offsides against Buffalo? Why was Patty Mahomes so upset? Now, I'm sitting on the fucking tarmac. I'm sitting at the GFK, the Grand Forks International. I'm sitting there for about 7 hours, so I don't catch the game. I'm watching a little bit of the Vikings game. Then I'm in the air, and I'm watching the Sunday Nighter with Dallas. So I didn't catch the full Kansas City-Buffalo game. But why was Patty Mahomes so upset? Had he not seen the clip yet, or you just seen it in real time? Because, I mean, Kadarius Toney, like, he was clearly offsides. Why was he so mad? He was like calling out the referees in the NFL. I'm like, buddy, that ain't it.
No, I guess usually when that happens, the ref tells the wide receiver, you know, he gives him a warning like, hey, you're over the line or whatever. Apparently Patty Mahomes is saying he didn't give him a warning or whatever, but I watched the video this morning and I'm sure Patty didn't see it either before when he was that, you know, riled up, which I get it. Players get riled up over that shit. You know, there's a call that you don't think happens to other teams or whatever, so you're mad. I get that part. What I didn't like about Patty Mahomes was him saying that to Josh Allen. Do you think Josh Allen gives a fuck that they gave you guys a bad call or whatever you think? Like, every team deals with bad calls every fucking game. You know, Patty Mahomes has won games off of bad calls on the other team, you know? So it's just like,
right,
know your crowd. Like, don't say this to a guy, Josh Allen, who's actually an incredible quarterback. You guys have had so many battles against each other, and now you're going to complain to this guy? Like you think he gives a fuck? Like, no, he doesn't. So this is the wrong guy to complain to, in my opinion, because at the end of the day, Josh Allen has nothing to do with that call, and he doesn't care that you just lost that game off a bad call either. So that was my only problem with it. But yeah, I mean, what an absolute J.R. Smith play by Kadarius Toney. I mean, is that guy high? He was fucking a foot off sides. It wasn't even close.
I was going to say, did he hit the Jamaican sauna over there in the blue tent before that play? Or what was going on? Like, did he go and hot box that thing and they have the medical tent on the sidelines? Because he was clearly, I would say, maybe even a yard offside, which is a lot, you know? If you're looking down the line, fella, like, how do you not notice that? But I didn't realize Patty Mahomeboy, that's why he was so mad, because the referee didn't say anything or signal to him, hey, fella, slide back a little bit. But at the same time, man, like, I don't know. And
Toney wasn't even looking at him, though. Usually the wide receiver's looking over at him. Toney wasn't looking at the ref. So the ref really couldn't tell him he was over the line.
Sure. Yep. Yeah, I don't know. And Mahomes, he's won games on non-calls or questionable calls. So it's like, dude, shut the fuck up. Joshie Allen, that's the last thing he wants here. He just stole one against the Kansas City Chiefs. Just survive in advance, baby. You know, you got you got bigger things to worry about. That was funny, Ozzy. The Chiefs, I don't know. I was a Mahomes, Kelce guy and all this whole Taylor Swift thing. I don't know if I can get behind them anymore, especially out of the AFC. So we will see how they're doing, but they're ruggling a little bit. And I wanted to ask you, what did you have for your Celly of the week, brother? Did you have, was it football? What'd you see out there? What were you sniffing on?
Man, I'm going to shout out. I saw Ben Steves do this. He plays for Duluth Bulldogs. He scores the shootout goal and the one-handed fucking backhand shelf shootout goal. You got to have Popeye forearms to do that. And he scores the goal and he goes.
No way. He did the one-hander?
Yeah, one-hander, top right, backhand shelf. Unbelievable.
Top shelf over the glove?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. It was insane. You got to have forearms, like you said, like Popeye, or you're fucking tugging a couple off a day. Jesus.
Oh, man. And he skates through the line with the stick in the air, and he goes through the line, you know, pounding the boys with the stick in the air. And it was kind of – I know the UND guys were doing that against Denver because Denver did it to them. I just think that's an unbelievable sell in hockey. Tuck one, just – stick in the air and skate through the fucking line. So nails. Just stick touching the rafters. Yeah. Yeah. It's unbelievable. So I had that one. I can't remember my NFL one just because I didn't watch too many games driving home from Grand Forks. But yeah, and I didn't have anything. I watched the Vikings game. There was no Cellies. It was almost fucking 0-0.
Did you catch the Vikings cake stand Celly on that recovered fumble, though?
Yeah, that was good. I forgot to mention that one.
That one was funny. I thought that was hilarious from the defense, the Vikings, the cake stand Celly after the recovered fumble. That was great. I had a couple written down. Gleb Veremiev from CC scored the OT winner right in front of our jaws. On Saturday night, a little breakaway forehand, backhand. How's your mother? Ask her what's up. Ask her if she's up. Scores, tucks it against UND, sucked. And then he hits the heartbreaker, Patty Kane Showtime special, Celly, right in front of the student section. I mean, that kid, he'll remember that goal for the rest of his life. Nails. I believe, you know, DC, that's going to be their Super Bowl of the year. They're going to talk about that from the time they, you know, next weekend to the time they're done playing 100%. There. So, that was their Super Bowl. I thought that was an awesome Celly. And the one I had from the NFL was Michael Gallup caught a little in route with the Cowboys, about a 6-yard score, maybe less. He hit the Jordan shrug. Just I love that. Yeah. Just nice and easy. You know, keep the change. I'm a nail gun. So that one was good. Ozzo, I know it's Monday and we're recording a little earlier this week. So it's really tough to make a prediction in terms of week 15 over here on the slate. Monday, always tough. But if you're looking at one game just across the big board, what are you looking at? I'm going to give you my pick just because I think it really stood out to me looking across the ESPN app. I had Broncos at Detroit. I think Russell Wilson is finding the screws. That's +5 against Detroit at Ford Field. So I just think with Goff throwing 4 picks, I think Dan Campbell is an emotional roller coaster. I think their buttholes are going to be puckered up, and I think Denver is going to go in there and probably win that game. And I even like having those 5 extra points just in case they don't do it. I think it's going to be a close game. So I got Denver Broncos. I don't know if that line will move, but I got them +5 at Ford Field going into Motown saying thank you kindly.
I like that. I like that call. I am definitely going with the Bengals to cover 3.5 against the Vikings. They're at home. I just don't know how the Vikings could even 3.5 points. They're going to get blown out. I don't know if anyone watched that game because it was one of the most boring football games of all time, but their offense with these quarterbacks is so brutal. It is insanely bad. There's no way they even come close to the Cincinnati Bengals team, who's actually playing pretty well right now. So I've got the Bengals to cover 3.5 against the Vikings.
Yeah, without Chelly sure. Ice.
Yeah, yeah. So that's my pick.
I like it. I like it. Yeah, we talked about it, but the quarterback play is just atrocious. Like, it's actually bad. Insane. Someone needs to call up, I don't know, Brucey from the longest yard, or can we get Uncle Rico in there snapping a few, like a gunslinger? Like,
yeah,
it's just awful. And I don't want to be negative because I love watching football, but this year to me, it seems like it's just down and it's just dog shit at times. So I like that pick, Ozzo, the Bengals, and we're looking at the Denver Broncos. Nail gun of the week. Let's start with that. We'll go over to that. Did you have a nail gun of the week? What do you got for me, fella?
I had a nail gun of the week. I've only got one, and I'm going to give it to you, Jordo. I'm going to give it to Jordan Schmaltz, his first time on TV, on live TV. I know how much balls that takes to get in there. Without, you know, most of those people doing that, Jordo, a lot of them, you know, went to school for it. They're journalists. They know what they're doing. You pop right in there. You looked like a fucking veteran. I know everyone in the suite level and everyone we watched the game with watched and followed along, thought you did a great job. So I had to shout you out. You're definitely the nail gun of the week.
Oh, thanks, brother. I appreciate it. No, like I said, I had a lot of fun. I think I've always wanted to do this in some aspects. So, you know, one fucking weekend doesn't make a career, but it was a great start and I had a lot of fun. So,
yeah.
Thank you, Ozzo. I appreciate that. My nail gun of the week. Tony Granato, the Granato family, as you know, Ozzo, you played for Donnie Meatballs at the U.S. Yep. program, so this probably hits a little bit to home. I've known the Granato family just being around Wisconsin, the Illinois area for
sure.
15 years of my youth life. It sucks, man. Tony's a great man. Not only was he a great coach and a player, well, now he got into the broadcasting space again after being let go by Wisconsin. He was doing cool things with the Hawks. It just sucks. He was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and a guy, this has got to even hit you, Ozzy. I mean, you've battled the likes of cancer and different things like that, and it hits people at certain times and different times of their life. You really early, and it sucks, man.
It's crazy.
And you feel for a guy, and I'm sure, you know, with what everything you've gone through, you could you know, attest to this, and you just wish people well. And like all hockey guys, they're tough on the outside, but man, it's got to be very tough for the Granato family. So we wish them the best. We hope and we know that Tony will get through this. He's a nail gun, he's a small stature guy, but fuck, he played so hard and he's a feisty bastard. So he will win this fight. But Ozzy, I just wanted you to touch on this because I know this would hit home with you, brother.
Yeah, he's an absolute nail gun. So, you know, if it is going to happen to someone, you know what? They picked a bad, you know, cancer picked a bad man to try to defeat, because he's going to give it his all for sure. And like you said, it just sucks. You never know when it's going to hit. You never know who it's going to hit. And when it does, you know, I'll say it's mostly a very negative thing. But you know what, from my experience, when it happens to you, or when it happens to, I'm sure, you know, someone close in your family that means a lot to you, it really makes you realize what really doesn't matter in life. You know, those things that piss you off or wreck your day sometimes, you get stressed out about, it really makes you realize, you know, those things don't matter. And, you know, you wasting your time on getting mad or getting yourself stressed out or worrying about these little things that happen in your life that really don't matter, it really opens your eyes to that, and it makes you realize, you know, it makes you a little more grateful for what you have, who you have around you, the people you have, the experiences, you know, what you've done. You appreciate your past a little more because you're like, I don't know how much future I have. So it does bring some positive things for sure. But overall, I mean, probably negative, but you know, there are some positives to take out of it. It just sucks. You know, like you said, it can happen to anyone, and you know, it's just a good reminder to, you know, keep on and stay positive. You know, obviously, you know, keep your loved ones close and, you know, make time for them, because at the end of the day, that's really what matters, are the people in your life that you care about. And I guess that's all I have to say about that.
No, that's great, Ozzo. And like we said, someone that's been through the ranks of that and through the the bad times and, you know, seeing the other side. So Tony Granato, giving him a shout out, especially around the holiday times. Hope he is okay. And he's got a battle ahead, but we're all behind him, especially in the hockey community. Over to the association, Ozzo, the NBA, my favorite league, probably not our viewers or our listeners' favorite league, but that's okay. We're all different, baby. They just finished up and or wrapped up their in-season tournament in none other than Las Vegas, Nevada. So the Lakers are the champions of the in-season tournament, each player walking away with $500K in their pockets. Yes, that's not a lot for NBA players, especially some guys making upwards of $60 million. But when you still get $500K and you win a tournament, I mean, that's still a lot of dough. Yeah. So I wanted to ask you, even Ozzo, if you were making $15 million, $20 million a year, and you were treating the $500K, maybe how, you know, we would treat $10K, you know, just based on salaries or whatever. What are you doing with that extra $500, especially for the association? Like, are you buying a car? Are you treating the boys in the summer to a private bird? Maybe you're taking the UND Sioux golf trip. Like, hey, boys, I got the 18-seater. Yeah. We'll sew the bird up. Let's get over to, you know, Vegas. We'll have a time. We'll stay two nights at the penthouse, the Wynn, or maybe the player's suite over at Andreas or 100%. One of these, you know, clubs. Or what would you what would you do with that $500K, bro?
Yeah, I think it, you know, it all depends on what part of life you're in, I think, especially if you're in the NBA. But right now, you know, if I'm one of those guys, it's 100%. It's going towards the boys, you know, a trip in the summer. You know, this is the in-season tournament, you know, bonus trip. And I'm probably even heading right back to where I fucking won it. I'm heading back to the strip, but I'm fucking throwing it down. And I guarantee you none of that is coming back home with me. It's being all spent on the boys. And we're having ourselves a fucking time. I don't exactly know where we're going yet. But you know what? Once we dig into it, we'll find that out. Probably find the nicest fucking table. Maybe even go back to Wet Republic. You know, we had a great time there. I wouldn't mind doing that again. So that's probably what I'm doing with it. But yeah, I mean, I think that this in-season tournament thing's cool because those bench players get that too. So some of these guys on the bench, you know, like who aren't getting paid a ton, they get that little bonus middle of the season. Like that's fucking big time.
The old Rick bonus. Yeah, right in your back pocket. You could maybe even make $1 million. You get that $500K, but like you said, Wet Republic, dust off the Amex, fella. You could spend $500K probably there and
oh yeah,
3 hours. I mean, especially if you got a guy like Drake Pajula ordering the old champagne Don with the Tiger service and a couple skunks, you know, dragging them out like it's a goddamn, you know, magic show. So I think you can really rack it up in terms of, you know, just a fireworks show. I mean, put your fucking price tag on it. Name your price, fella. You could spend $500K in probably 3 or 4 hours the way they dust off the Amex at that place. I mean, I remember our bill. We won't say it on the air here, but we had 20 guys. And, Jesus.
That's insane.
Let's just say you could buy a nice little fucking Kia, you know, for that what we got. You know, so maybe even brand new. Too. You might be able to get a Toyota Camry for what that tag costs. Yeah. I know cars are getting more expensive, but dude, that was a hefty one. Thank God I didn't. I was in the house. I was with the night before I contributed. So the fella that we know who paid for that night. At least we got the chicken finger basket to come with it. Cause that was a life size affordable 4-door sedan that we dusted off. So I would do something similar though. I would think just with my stage in life,
for sure.
I think I'm spending it on the fellas. We're going somewhere and we're just getting absolutely tattooed. So that's where we're at. Ozzo, a couple announcements. We're going to have John Buccigross coming on here just right after the show. Thank you for all for staying with us. Brought to you always by Butter Golf and Mini Movers. Folks, if you need your shit packed, you know someone that's moving. Midwest, wherever it is, I'm sure the Mini Movers are maybe even nationwide now. So for the right price, Ozzo will drive down and pack that shit yourself. That's the mover of the year you're talking to. Folks, if you're looking for something lifestyle-wise, Butter Golf around the holiday seasons, go check it out at www.butter.golf. And the last announcement, Ozzo, as a part of Hockey Night in Scottsdale, me and the Heat Daddy, our first live show, we're going up to Cowboys for a live show, Boots on the Ground, Battle of Alberta, Hockey Night in Scottsdale, Cowboys Saloon Dance Hall. It's right next to the Saddle Dome. So fired up for that. That's January 20th, but that's all I got, Ozzo. Let's send it over to John Buccigross. This was an awesome chat with Bucci as he brought to us from Buffalo. He was calling a game the other week, just live from his bathroom at the Marriott. So awesome chat with Bucci. We'll send it over to him. Fella, that was Tape to Tape, as always. Episode 15 pre-show, Ozzo and Swish, baby. Woo! Folks, we are now pleased to be joined by zero-time Emmy Award winner, the pride of Eastern Ohio. This Heidelberg College graduate has been at the helm of ESPN since 1996. This 6'4" wiry fella has worked in various roles in Bristol, Connecticut, over his 27-year run, starting with Baseball Tonight, SportsCenter, NHL Tonight, and most recently being a play-by-play guy for NHL games, as well as covering the Frozen Four since, I believe, 2012. Bucci's coined term, nominally good, best describes his golf game to a T, no pun intended, as the lengthy half-Irish, half-Italian brother has had a handful of hole-in-ones on his resume, including one of those coming on a par four. But to quote the man himself, he doesn't like to talk about it. A chicken parm connoisseur and lover of bourbon to boot. Folks, please welcome the voice of ESPN Hockey, John Bucci Buccigross, to the Live and Five podcast. Bucci, how are you doing, brother?
Boys, I am feeling great. It's great to be with two hockey beauties. That was very well done. Maybe add some music and post-production. But just two hole-in-ones, not a handful, zero Emmy time winner, but now just two. Early in my career, I realized at the local level where I started that in order to win an Emmy, you had to actually pay. And then you had to put together your best stuff and write a check to the local Emmy committee or something and send it in. I'm like, what? That's not how I was raised. So it was my goal then at the start of my career to never win an Emmy.
So you got,
and here we are.
Pay to play. Yeah, I was gonna say you got to pay to play.
It's
yeah.
a pay
it's a
to
local
play.
Cabaret pay or a youth AAA hockey team. You got to pay
yeah,
to play.
Right. Yeah, I'm not sure if that's the case now at the national level. I don't think Scott Van Pelt's writing checks to get nominated. Sure. But yeah. I think it's different now. Now ESPN might do them for us. I don't know. You know, they nominate. Mm-hmm. So back in the day, right. NHL Tonight got nominated for an Emmy, which was great. It was the first ESPN 2 show ever to get nominated. I was a nominee. It was the whole show. And so that was pretty cool. That was kind of cool. But I'm glad we didn't win because I don't want to win one.
Right. No, this is – we're going for zero. We're going for the goose egg, the old Gilbert Arenas, agent zero. So, yes. Bucci, no, thanks for joining us, brother. I believe you're in Buffalo right now. You're in the Rust Belt.
I am.
Chippewa Street tonight, or are you taking it easy? Because, you know, there's speculation that Patty Kane might be going tomorrow night, but it's looking like he might not. So what's the agenda like the day before a game in terms of gearing up for a broadcast, being a play-by-play guy?
It kind of starts, you know, as soon as I'm got my next game, and I've had this game on the schedule for a while. So I just really start focusing on the Sabres and the Red Wings. I watch all their games leading up to it. I watch hockey every night, just a lot of the games every night. But as I get closer to my game, I'll make sure I watch those two teams if they're on. And that's what I've been doing. And then you read all the articles. I get emailed a list of articles. Every team's this. I don't even know who it is. Somebody compiles all these articles that all these different news outlets that write about these teams. They put them in alphabetical order, and then they email to me every day. I really appreciate it. I'm not sure who's doing it.
That's sweet.
It's great. Yeah. And so I'll cut and paste stuff and put that on notes on my phone. And throughout, if I see a quote or something, I think it's interesting. So it's like a nice slow build. I really enjoy the process. And then the night before, last night, the Red Wings didn't play. So I'll start to work on my line sheets. I like to write them out by hand on manila folders, a little different. Most people have all these Excel spreadsheets and color code. I like to write them myself. It's like a Zen thing. I enjoy doing it. So I'll go on hockeyreference.com. I'll get their this year's stats, their career stats, you know, maybe other couple notes I like, awards and things. And then the day before the game today, we fly in. I came in. I live south of Boston most of the time. So I flew in a quick hour flight, get in the night before, and just, you know, go get down, get some nice, get a nice meal. We're actually at the same hotel as the Red Wings. So I saw some of them coming in today. and go down and get a nice meal, have a couple glasses of brown, and just kind of commiserate. Now, the only bad thing about this, normally I'm with my partner, but because Ryan Callahan lives so close in Rochester, he doesn't come in till tomorrow. I'm going to chirp him because that's pretty lame. Like, he should be here tonight.
Right.
Put the kids to bed, get to the bar. You know, the kids are in bed at 8.
Be a professional.
9:30. Be a pro.
Let's have a hot stove about this match.
After this, I'm going to give it to him. It's like, you should be here the night before. He's going to come tomorrow morning anyway. He's got to leave at 8 a.m., 9 a.m.
Right.
You know, mom can take him to school.
Yeah, he's going day of game travel. So, Bucci, like, tomorrow, will you go to morning skate? You know, will you get a work? I know you're a big workout guy. Will you get a workout in yourself? And I wanted to ask you, are you still doing the Dan Ugla special, 50 sets of 50 curls? Because I know for a while there, you're on that, you know? Like, I'm a big believer in you can't tone it, tan it, but you got to be able to tone it as well.
That's something you never give up. You get that in every – it never stops. Yeah.
It's the only fountain of youth. Weight training is the only fountain of youth to man. Yeah. But I don't work – I work out so hard at home, probably almost – and in fact, I'm susceptible to overtraining because I enjoy it so much. When I leave the gym, I can't wait to go back the next day. Like, I don't take credit for being in shape because it's easy for me. I love going. It's not a sacrifice at all. So when I come for a game, I make sure I don't do anything. I use it as my days of rest. So I just hang out, I sleep, I work on my, line charts. I go to the morning skate tomorrow. And then the coaches talk to the general media. And then us as rights holders, national rights holders, we get to talk to the coaches one-on-one. And I love that because so many of them are so candid. Some are protected, like they're protective and a little, like they're still auditioning for the job. Some of the young guys, I won't mention their names. Mm-hmm. It's like, dude, you have the job. You don't have to impress me. It's like every time Mike Babcock was interviewed, he was like trying to sell a inspirational book that he wrote. It's like, no, ease back, dude. You get off the gas a bit. Just be yourself. You're just a bunch of guys talking. We'll protect you. You can tell us. And like John Cooper is really honest. Bruce Cassidy, they give us so much great stuff that we can't use. And they know that, but it gives us a foundation. So if he says somebody sucks, I'm not going to say they're great. I'm not going to say they suck. But I might say they're struggling, but I'm not going to say they're having a great year. So you protect them. You protect their for what they give you, how candid they are. And I really, Don Granato's fun to talk to.
Donnie Meatballs.
And of course, Derek Lalonde is phenomenal. And
I'm looking for him.
Hope I see him at the bar, actually. But I'll see him tomorrow morning. The skate, but we see the skate, and then we'll come back. We'll have lunch somewhere, probably in the hotel. This Marriott has a nice lunch, kind of high up, overlooks the city, and then just take this. It's really like a lot of like a player. We get up, we go to pregame skate, we come back, we have a little lunch, then we take a nap and just kind of chill, get the room dark, just even if you're just horizontal, just resting, rebooting, and you get up and you walk to the rink about 2 hours before the game. So it is a lot like a player's rhythm in that way.
For sure. And it's like, hey, whoa, Babs, like you can open up a little bit, fella. Like, what do we need to do to get to know each other? You need to see my phone? What's going on here? But that's like, come on, man. You can tell us more than the forecheck here. So Bucci, I just wanted to, you know, kind of take it back in terms of you've been at ESPN since 1996. And I'm not a math guy, almost your whole life, dude.
Almost
27 years. Yeah. That's the same year that my brother was born. So, I read somewhere like you had your first opportunity, maybe right out of school, you know, somewhere in Cape Cod. And I believe I would even seen your tweets before, because I love reading your tweets where you're making like $14,000 a year. So how many years did you from the time you graduated with a communications degree in Eastern Ohio, you know, what was the process to get to ESPN? Was it a couple of years or was it, you know, a few? What was that like?
Well, life was weird back then. Again, I graduated in 1988. This is pre-internet by a lot of years. So I graduated in Ohio. I moved to New England in the summer of 88. And just my first job was at the Boston Harbor Hotel gift shop, which is still there in Boston, has the big archway, the big opening, really great hotel. And just did that. And just, okay, how do you find a job? I didn't know how to find a job. I never went to a job fair. I never had an internship. Yeah. I was a little unconventional. I just started looking at, I don't know, newspapers, I guess. I looked in the newspaper. And then my parents moved down to Plymouth, Massachusetts, south of Boston. So I moved in with them. And the first place I looked for a job was in the phone book and in TV stations, in the yellow pages. That's how I look. That's why I tell young kids, and that's how I looked for my first job, in the yellow pages of the phone. And they're like, what's a phone book? Well, that's where all the phone numbers used to be, in alphabetical order. And you try to, you know, you need somebody's phone number. So that's what I did. There was a station on Cape Cod over the air, you know, the kind you can get with your antenna, your UHF back in the day. And they said, yeah, you can come here, but we don't have any openings, but if you want to work for free. Now, little did I know at the time, this place was bleeding cash. It was on its last legs, and it wouldn't exist in a year. But again, this is early 1989 now, like March of 89. Yeah, you can come in there. So I got a job at the Cape Cod Mall at Chess King. So I was poor with terrible fashion, but it was 40% off discount. So that's how I clothed myself. And so I would go in, and they were great. They would let me do a lot of stuff hands-on. I wasn't on the air. But I would, like, you know, shoot stuff with a camera, and I would edit, and I would write some stuff, and he would use it sometimes. And he told me about this small station across town that was like cable access, like Wayne and Garth. The only people who had cable with this particular cable company, the middle of Cape Cod, they got this Cape 11 news. There's eight of us, typewriters, still no computers. And so I went there, and she's like, I got nothing for you, but, you know, leave me your tapes. I left her a tape. And then about 2 months later, she created a position of night photographer, where I'd go out with the news reporter to school board meetings. And I would just like photograph her, and she would do her reports, Christina DeFranco. And I did that. And so I was part-time, 4 to 10, 30 hours a week. And I was about $10,000 a year. And then it became full-time January 1st. And I could also fill in when the regular sports guy wasn't there. That was part of the original deal. And so I was doing that. So I was August of 89 when I started there. I was 23 years old, 23 and a half, January birthday. And so I just started filling in and photogging. And then I got the guy left the following April. And so that's when now it's 1990. I'm 24 years old. And that's when I start Monday through Friday, 5 days a week, anchoring local sports on Cape Cod. And I was there and a lot of people go there for 2-3 years, and they try to go to like Charleston, South Carolina, or Manchester, New Hampshire, or maybe Sioux Falls, like a market that's a decent little market, but still not that big. But I wanted to skip that step. Even though I was making no money, but I got married young at 25, then had two kids. I like Cape Cod. It's near my parents. I like the golf in the summer there. I just like the vibes. It's like, you know what? I'm going to try to skip that middle step and see if I can then make a little jump from there. And again, I'm married. And I have a son. I'm making 18 grand a year. Then I have a daughter. I'm making about 18.8 a year in 1994. And then I get a chance to work in Providence, Rhode Island, which was the 44th biggest market. So I kind of did skip that step and got to a nice sized market, local affiliate. I covered Bruins training camp, Celtics and Patriots and Red Sox opening day. So I got a taste of the big time. And I was there for 2 years. And then bam, in the mid 90s, corporations started to buy media companies, and Walt Disney bought ESPN and ABC. And it was just a great time to be 30 years old, because the media world was exploding. The internet was coming. So I was 30 years old with like 7 years experience. So I was young, experienced, and cheap. So I was a perfect hire for ESPN. Yeah. And luckily they started ESPN News, which was a 24-hour, you know, 48 half-hour sports cast a day. And they needed people. It was like an expansion team. They needed like 15 anchors. Normally ESPN would hire one or two anchors a year. But now suddenly they needed 12 to 15 right off the bat. And here I am, 30 years old, 2 hours away in Rhode Island. Not going to cost a lot. Not going to cost a lot to move. I just had to drive my car 2 hours. And I had no stuff. Yeah. And they didn't have to worry about a moving van. So yeah, it was pretty bottom of the barrel. We got free government cheese and assistance from the government because we're poverty wages. When you make 18 grand a year and you have a wife and two kids, you qualify for government assistance.
That Velveeta's not too bad though. Eh?
I love Velveeta grilled cheese.
You can make a good grilled cheese.
You eat your Gouda. Give me the Velveeta.
Yeah.
So that's how it started. October 28th, 1996, my first day at ESPN. And now we're on 27 years in about a month. So I'm signed for 2.5 more years. So I'll make it to at least just shy of 30 years. So hopefully I get one more deal to get me to 30 at least. But if that doesn't work out, it'll finish up at 29 years and 8 months. So
is that how it works with everyone at ESPN? You kind of just sign deals just like players do, like professional athletes. Like, you know, you get that contract and you kind of. So do you negotiate that yourself? Do you have like someone, like an agent almost doing it?
Yeah, you work with Rich Paul?
Agents. mean, most people have agents, and the big boys have big time agents, but I had an agent when I got there. And then I signed my first deal was a 4-year deal. It was a 2. They had an option after 2. So they could decide whether to keep me or cut me after 2 years. They kept me. So the other 2 kicked in. Then I signed a 3-year deal with a nice bump because I kind of established myself. But then the next couple, I signed a 1-year deal. It might have been another 1-year deal. I can't believe it might have been 2 in a row. And I'm like, you know what? I can do this myself. His job is to get me leveraged somewhere. We're not getting leveraged. Yeah. I'm paying him 7% gross. Now they pay 10% gross to their agent. Ooh. And so, you know, I'll do this myself. The first deal I signed was terrible, but it was quick. You know, it was little tiny raises, but it was fine. It was a 3-year deal. I finally got some security. I didn't have to pay any commission, kept it myself. And then from there, I've done my last 3 contracts, 5 years, 5 years, 4 years, the last 14 years by myself. And I've done, and I haven't had any commissions, and I may not have made as much as I could, but I feel like I control the narrative. I know what's being said. I don't know if this agent's going to work for another client harder. He wants to push them to get that job because maybe they feel like his commission is more. And he's going to put me in this job, and they're like playing chess with their clients. So I'm for like, sure. I'd rather know what's going on and know what's happening. And I can take it, and I have thick skin, and I don't have to make the most, and I don't worry about – I've always told other anchors at ESPN, if we all told each other what we made, we'd all make more, like the NHL players did in the mid-90s when they decided to make them public. Then Ray Bourque knew that Scott Stevens was making $5 million, and he didn't have to take $2 million from the Bruins. You know, gosh, I can't believe – because now once you have a comparable, then they're actually fair too. So once you know what someone else is making in a comparable role, if you go to ESPN or you go to an employee and you say, hey, I deserve $250, and they don't know that you know that this other person made, they're like, okay, yeah, that seems fair. And they'll do it, you know? So that information is gold. But so you just have to do the best you can. And it's worked out fine. The people I've dealt with at ESPN, they've been professional. They've never been dicks. They've been good. And they treated me professionally, and like I said, I'm very, very happy for my 27 years there.
Imagine that would be so funny if there was like a cap friendly for ESPN anchors, or just like, you could just go on there and be like, "Fuck, Bucci's got a nice
I'm
bonus."
I'm sure someone on
July
started
1st.
One in the business. That's a nice ticket. Great idea. I bet if someone started a website for media salaries and they went to people individually, listen. Here's what you want to do. Now, some people, their ego couldn't take it if they found out they're making less than somebody else. But I bet you'd get a lot of people who would offer that information. Yeah, I'll tell you what I'm making. And and then they'll have this database and they'll have maybe a password, and you might pay like $50 a year for it because they're giving you information. And this guy's working on it. And that would be
so funny. You're looking at, say, like Pat McAfee's deal. Like, man, he's got a front-loaded signing bonus and a player option in that year. And he's got a no-movement clause. Jesus, I need that deal. But
5-star hotels only?
Yeah, that's what I mean. He's got a chef. He's, you know, flying private. What's going on? But
he's not doing podcasts in a bathroom. He's not doing a podcast in a bathroom, you know? He's got his...
Right. He's got the mood lighting on, and it's a fucking Monday night in Buffalo. But, Bucci, take us back to those early days of ESPN. Like, when they hired, you know, you talk about expansion, and what was it like? Like, who were you coming in with some of the guys? Was it like, you know, the late Stuart Scott? Was it John Anderson? Was it SVP? Who were some of those guys that all came in at the same time? Or was it Steve Levy? Like, who were you thrown right into the fire with when you got that job when you were 30 years old going down to Bristol, Connecticut?
Well, that was ESPN News. So that was Mike Greenberg. I think me and Greeny, the only ones left from that original class of 96.
Really?
The class before us, that's when ESPN2 kind of started, right? And that was Stuart Scott, Reese Davis, Carl Ravitch. They were kind of part of the ESPN2 group. Linda Cohn was a little before that.
Okay.
But certainly when I was there, Dan Patrick was still there. Keith Olbermann was still there. Bob Lee, Charlie Steiner, Robin Roberts. So it was cool. I was still right in the heyday. And that's pretty much the heyday. And I'm glad I got to be a part of that because that was such a cool time. It was so exciting. Again, there's no phones yet. There's no internet video yet. And it wasn't even very good for a few years. So you need the Sports Center and ESPN was much more valuable and impactful than it is today. Because the kids just look at their phones and they don't have to watch ESPN anymore. But back then you did. And so it was appointment viewing and you were a part of that. So I'm just so glad I touched that last golden era of television. And of course, now it's the internet and it's the phone. But you know, to be a part of that last era, really probably from 96, probably to about 2009, 10, you know, because the iPhone didn't come along until what, 2007. So people uh-huh. still weren't living on their phone yet. So I really had a good 15 years there where ESPN was really the thing. And to be a part of that and to help certainly elevate me and build me up so I could have this nice career and have a part of nostalgia. Because again, you know, kids your age come up to me all the time. It kind of started about 2 years ago. And they started to come up to me if I go to a basketball game or a hockey game, especially people come up, you take a picture, they say hi. And but it just started a couple years ago. It was like, I grew up with you in middle school. I'd eat my cereal and I'd watch you do highlights in the morning. And at yeah. first I was like, damn, yeah. I feel old. But that was really cool. And I was actually a part of their life, like a part of their upbringing. And I know a lot of my career now is more nostalgia. They look at me as I'm one of the old goats. It's like, man, I see you. And that kind of reminds me of my childhood. And that does have some value. It probably has some value for ESPN. It's why they probably one reason why they might keep me around a little bit, because I do. I'm kind of a link to that past. You know, Scott Van Pelt came after me. John Anderson came after me. We're about the, you know, mm-hmm. we're in the, you know, similar. Steve Levy came before me, but we're all the same age. Me, Anderson, Van Pelt, you know, Levy, Chris Fowler, Herb Street's a little younger. But so, yeah, so so our sensibilities are the same. We were raised the same in the 70s and 80s. You know, wiffle ball, riding your bike all summer, no cable TV. You lived outside. You know, your mom screamed outside, come on for dinner. You know, then you go back outside oh, yeah. again. You lived outside. It's just a different existence than the kids have today. And I'm so glad I experienced. But like I said, I've always said I've kind of straddled technology, you know. I was 30 when kind of the internet started. So I had 30 years before and I've had almost 30 years since. So I kind of like, you know, I like being able to talk to you guys on a phone. That's cool. You mm-hmm. know, and I like getting an Uber at the airport on my phone and making travel plans and doing banking. That's good. There's good parts of technology, but I also try to realize, you know, to keep the good stuff about the past too, connecting with people, hanging out with people, living life, looking around. It was a great time. It was like the Wild West. It was just so exciting. ESPN was a rocket ship. And just the people that would walk through there. Here, look, here comes Cam Newton. Here comes this person. Especially when I worked in the afternoon for about 4 years. I did the noon to three, 5 days a week. I mean, I interviewed The Rock. I interviewed Vince yeah. Vaughn, you know, Matthew Stafford. Here comes, like I said, Cam Newton, Aaron Hernandez. I had to sit down with Aaron Hernandez for 10 minutes. So it was like, oh, and I think of all the people who've been walking through the news. They're going, that's right. I remember I was there when Hunter S. Thompson was there, this famous writer that people go nuts over. And David Halberstam, an amazing writer. And I forgot I was there when that person was there. And I was there when this person was there. It's been an amazing, just being in Bristol has been amazing. And now getting on the road, doing 11 Frozen Fours, and now doing the NHL, doing play-by-play. It's been a great life.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about that, Bucci. Like, you're at ESPN, you're obviously meeting all these just extraordinary people. You know, obviously mm-hmm. the first couple of times you're probably shell-shocked. I mean, do you ever get over that? Or are you still like kind of starstruck sometimes when these guys walk in and you're like, this is pretty damn cool? Because I mean, at this point, yeah, you're kind of one of them, you know, you're kind of a celebrity like they are, but it's still cool to see these people and get to talk to them and kind of hear their story and just see how they live their lives.
Yeah, I'm not really starstruck. Maybe when I was really younger, a little bit, but you know, I interviewed Bobby Orr when I was 24 years old. On Cape Cod with my own tripod, said, Bobby, please don't move. I got to put this camera here. Then I'm going to sit down here and then talk to you like I'm a reporter. I got to do both. And so that was cool. But that was, I mean, Bobby, I was a little kid. I listened to him on the radio growing up in Ohio. You know, not every game was on TV back then. So I did a lot of radio listening. Where you kind of invent the game in your head when you listen to it on the radio. Everything takes uh-huh. on, you know, your senses get pounded. I listened to hockey games as a kid. To me, it was like a gothic experience. It was like goth. It was like blood. It was the church yeah. organ. Arenas were like churches, the Boston Garden, Chicago Stadium, like old churches with organs and blood. And it just reminded yeah. me of going to church with, you know, it really did. And so it was, that's why hockey always had a very visceral experience for me, because I mm-hmm. invented it in my head, because I exaggerated all the descriptions from the Homer play-by-play people talking about the fights and talking about all this stuff. And I listened to it and the crowd noise. I was just, and like I said, most of it was on the radio because very few games were on TV. There wasn't much of a national TV package. A few Penguins games were on because I always lived near Pittsburgh. And we'd go to a couple games a year. And I just could not wait to go to these couple games a year. I would sit in Civic Arena in Pittsburgh and I'd watch these games. And as soon as the clock hit 9 minutes and 59 seconds to go in the second period, I started to get depressed. My stomach would start to hurt because the game was more than halfway over. And as a nine-year-old kid, I was so sad. I'd get sick. I'd get nauseous. And then when my team had the puck, when the other team had the – I was a Bruins fan growing up, so we'd go see the Bruins play. When the Penguins had the puck in the Bruins' end, I would get nauseous again. I'd get so nervous. I'd get that puck out. That was the difference then because there's no Jumbotron. So you have to stare at the ice or it's gone forever. You'll never see it again. You have to be laser focused. And nowadays, kids don't have to be laser focused on anything because they have backups on the Jumbotron, on the phone. And so they just don't look and, I think, envelop and digest the game like my generation did. It was life or death. And then when you played on your high school team or whatever team, your little league in the summer, it was life or death. And I was where I grew up in these blue collar, steel mill, kind of depressing economies areas. The coaches were so hard and the parents were so intense. They worked in steel mills and mines and they were so intense. And I loved it though, because it was always life or death for me. So and any competitor wants to have a serious, structured coach. He wants a demanding coach. He wants a demanding game. That's what competitors want. So, and I was hyper competitive, almost too competitive. But it was perfect for me growing up. And that's how I digested the sports when I watched as well. So by the time, I built this huge database of knowledge and rules and passion and remembering things for every sport. Cause I watched everything that it fit my job perfectly now. And it still helps me to this day. You know, I can still recall things from a long time ago and have great historical basis as well. And it's fun learning new things as well, new players as well. And the college game has really helped my NHL job because I know a third of the league intimately already once they enter the league, more than most play-by-play guys do.
That's true.
For sure. And Bucci, you know, working at ESPN for, 27 odd years and being able to work with just different personalities and guys you've been able to do co-host SportsCenter with, and one thing about SportsCenter that I always just admired so much was just like the one-liners you guys brought to, say, a SC top 10. Like, someone that really stands out to me, and I think he's retired now maybe, is a guy like Neil Everett. Like, anytime there was a home run in an MLB game, he'd be like, "Bartender, how about a Jack?" You know, or just like Stuart Scott going off, like, "That boy is butter because he's on a roll." You know, like some of these one-liners you always had, and Stuart Scott, you know, he always used "as cool as the other side of the pillow." So, like, who were some of those guys that, you know, you really looked forward to going on air with for a late night anchor in terms of, you know, doing a SportsCenter with? Because I mean, I'm sure all those guys were great, but did you have one that really stood out and your chemistry you found was just electric? Like, you'd really feed off each other because you always have those favorites, right?
Yeah. Well, ESPN came on the air when I was 13, and I first saw it when I was about 14, 15. So we got it in Ohio where I lived. And when I first saw Chris Berman do SportsCenter, I'm like, oh my gosh. Yes. He was like Haley's Comet. No one had ever done it like that. He referenced music. He referenced history. He was a history major at Brown. And I always loved history growing up, sports history and, you know, American history as well. I'd always loved the Revolutionary War. I love all that shit. And so when I watched him, I go, oh my gosh, look at this guy. He's talking about music and history. He's having fun. And he really invented the catchphrase, was Chris Berman. So everybody who followed him felt like, geez, maybe I need one, or maybe it sounds fun to use one. And so he kind of invented it. And then it really blew up with Keith and Dan in the early 90s. And then, of course, Stuart came along and took it to another level. And then that was part of the thing. Like, you needed to have a catchphrase. You wanted to have something that maybe blew up. It went viral before there was such a thing as viral. And so you get there, and that is fun. And that's, SportsCenter is so scripted now, heavily produced. There's not a lot of room to breathe. We don't write a lot anymore, like any of those on-camera lead-ins, which you could really separate yourself from the rest of your peers that show you could write and be clever or smart or funny. But you're right. The top 10 is that one area now where you have time to shine. That's kind of like your palette. It's all on you. They give you the information. Play number 9. Here's what happened. But other than that, it's all up to you. You can say whatever you want. And that gives us our time to do our material a little bit. So that is a fun fun time. I did my first sports center with Stuart Scott Grammy night, 1997. Again, I was hired in October, but I didn't do my first sports center until February. And so that was, it was so cool. Now, certainly what's happened in the meantime, with just to have my first sports center with Stuart Scott, that's just really cool. And then from there, I did just with just about everybody, but you're right. It's fun doing it with different people, but it was for a while there, me and Scott Van Pelt had a run of sports centers. And every time we did it, you could just, this is the early iterations of Twitter, just as Twitter starting. And it just, you could tell people were excited. They kind of enjoyed us being together because we played off each other. Again, we have similar tastes, similar sensibilities. And so I didn't do a lot with Scott because he soon would go to radio. And when he came back, had his own show. But I'm still on his show from now and then. But I really loved being with Scott. It felt like a big event. It felt like a show, like a special big event. So that's what I liked about working with Scott. But now as time's gone on, you know, John Anderson, Steve Levy, they've become two of my best friends now. And just, you know, John is such a good writer. He's so witty. He really keeps me on my game. I know he pushes me to be better because I don't want to be embarrassed by his writing, his wit, and his little one-liner. So he really pushes me hard. I love working with Levy because Levy just loves to laugh, and I love making him laugh. And he just got this big jolly laugh. And so again, we went through our divorce at the same time, so we really bonded then. And I had kids early. He has kids late. He's in the middle of it. I'm done. And so it's kind of fun. And now we're both involved in hockey. So yeah, it's just fun. That's what's great. I always loved a different partner because I always like to play off my partner. If I work with Neil, he's going to be really loud and yell and scream. So I'll bring it down a notch. I always like balance when I was on. And so if it was a quiet person, or it was maybe with a woman who's a little quieter or not as confident because they get such crap on the internet anytime they go on TV, I'll try to be a little more expressive, try to pick them up, try to empower them and try to feel good about yourself. This is good, you know? And so I really enjoy playing off my partners, and that's what I loved.
Yeah. You can play up and down the lineup. You're you can play in the first line, you can play third line.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. Whatever get you 30 need. Goals. Your claim to fame though was that me and my brother would always be watching like in my parents' room on their bed and like waiting for SportsCenter to come on. I think it was at that time when you were doing like the midday circuit. And your call was always every top 10, it was always number 4, Bobby Orr. Like you still do that to this day. Like John Buccigross. Death, yeah, taxes, and Bucci saying number 4, Bobby Orr's.
I remember as a young, the PA announcers, you know, number 4, Bobby Orr in Boston, you know, and I was kind of my, and that I really started doing that because that's when we didn't have hockey, right, at ESPN, and we were like, you know, we're kind of the enemy of hockey. People looked at us as the enemy of hockey, even though I wrote my hockey column, which is actually the favorite thing I've done at ESPN was writing my hockey column from 2002 to 2017. I did it for 15 years, a weekly column, like 5,000 to 7,000 words a week. I would write long ass hockey columns, but it was great because it was my canvas. I could do whatever I want. I was the producer, the director. Mm-hmm. And so I really enjoyed that. And that culminated with, I wrote a column about watching my son's last hockey game, which if you Google Buccigross last game, it's me about watching my son's last game and going back and reliving his entire hockey career as a dad, watching my boy start at 6-year-old travel Mike and finishing playing in the semifinals of the state championship of Connecticut at Yale. And so that's what this column was. And I pretty much emptied the emotional tank from there. And I had nothing left as a writer after writing that, but I really enjoyed that. But yeah, those daytime. So number 4, Bobby Orr was kind of a tip to him. Then I just kept going because I know, you know, because people would stop me on the street and say, I like when you say that. And then certainly Bobby knows that I say it, and he's become a friend because, you know, back in the day when I did NHL Tonight, he was a player agent. So he's watching every night. I had no idea. I had no idea people watched NHL Tonight. We're at midnight, 1 a.m. Who's watching? And then I go to this charity golf event after 9/11. There's a charity golf event at Hudson National, a golf course outside New York City. And Bobby's at one hole. So people go get an autographed golf ball, take a picture with Bobby Orr. I'm like, holy. I had done the interview way back when in 94, but he's not going to remember that. Or make that 89, I'm sorry, 89, 90, when I interviewed him as a young TV broadcaster. And so, oh, there's Bobby at a 10th hole. And I was going to kind of, you know, I can't wait to say hi and maybe bring up that interview from so long ago. And I kind of make eye contact. He goes, John. I go, what? Bobby Orr knows who I am? But again, I host a 5-night a week hockey show. But guess how dumb I am and always have been. And just my sometimes like, oh, I guess people watch that show in hockey. At that time, again, I'm a young kid. I don't know that like if there's a show, everyone in that industry is going to watch. And also these industries are small. Like the hockey world is small, right? You guys know everybody and you know so many people. For sure. And they know somebody. Same with TV. It's such a – you think it's big because it's television and it's and all these famous people. And but it's like small, you know? And you know people and you connect with people quickly. And that's what's great about it. You make amazing friends. You know, my best friends are through TV and hockey. And so it was so cool to see, wow, Bobby Orr. But now at the time, I didn't understand that. But now I guess I get it. He's going to watch his players. He's going to check the highlights. Because, again, at that time – that's how you saw hockey highlights. There's no other place to see them. There's no internet video yet, you know? So it was so many lessons I've learned along the way that I, as this, you know, rube from the Midwest who knew nothing, no worldliness at all. It's been fun to learn these things along the way and look back at them and laugh.
For sure.
Bucci, who was that first, you know, crew of guys that was doing NHL Tonight? I believe it was you, Darren Pang, a.k.a. Panger, Chicken Parm Ferraro. Well, Ferraro
games primarily. But okay. Ferraro was still Panger. Playing. Yeah, so Ferraro was still playing. He was still playing. Yeah, I got hired in. I filled in the playoffs of '98, and they named me the host the fall of '98. Okay. And Ferraro was still playing for the Thrashers, so he would just play. So Ferraro would play his last 4 or 5 years in the league. His teams would miss the playoffs, and then he'd come and do NHL Tonight in the postseason. Panger did games mostly. He'd come to studio. It was mainly me and Melrose. That's pretty much what it was. Occasionally, Pang would show up. Occasionally, Brian Engblom would show up. But those guys mainly did games.
Was Levy doing games? Levy did games. Okay.
He did games. Yeah, he did games then. He did only games. And so it was mainly just me and Melrose all those nights. And until we lost the hockey package in 2004. And so that was, you know, it's about five, six seasons, I guess, of doing NHL Tonight and going to all-star games. I got to go to the Stanley Cup Finals starting 2001 the year. And I would do Sports Center reports. We called them news of the day, like a minute 15 piece that they would run on Sports Center after games, Stanley Cup Final games. So that was cool. So yeah, that's what's great about ESPN. You can do so many things from reporter to anchorman on Sports Center. To host a specialty show like NHL Tonight. And as you mentioned at the intro, I used to fill in for Baseball Tonight before I didn't have a main gig until that noon to three on SportsCenter starting in 2009. I was there for 13 years before I had a regular gig, not counting NHL Tonight for 9 months. But then after hockey was over, here's ESPN News, here's a Baseball Tonight, here's an occasional SportsCenter. It wasn't until 2009, I had that noon to three, I had Monday through Friday, I knew what my schedule would be. And that was big for my career because I was on five days a week during the day, which ESPN wasn't when I was a kid. They didn't really go during the day until the mid-2000s. And I think all the executives there saw me and like, oh, normally they're in bed late at night when I was on at 2 a.m. But it's like, wow, this guy's pretty good. Interviewing The Rock and talking to Vince Vaughn and being very comfortable. And so that was a big break for me. That brought me a notch up. And from there, I went to the 11 o'clock Sports Center, which is the most watched Sports Center. And that's where I've been since we got the hockey back. So now it's just hockey during the hockey season. And then I'll do a few Sports Centers in the summer. So that's like my dream schedule.
For sure. And just, I mean, even back then, it probably had to be a dream just to get that job with NHL Tonight, being a big hockey advocate, like you mentioned, watching those old Pittsburgh Penguin games. But
right.
Booch, let's touch on Barry for a minute here. You know, how's he doing? Especially guys like us that played in the Frozen Four, got to know him. You know, we would show up the day early. I played in two Frozen Fours. Ozzy played in three, ended up winning that one. But it was always so cool just to show up the day before, talk to you guys. Barry, you know, obviously famous for his suits. But those days, you know, before the game, he'd be like a slick back, hair greased down. I don't know if that was L.A. looks or that was straight motor oil, but he had the look. He had the leather jacket on, the baggy jeans, the boot cut, probably a sick pair of like gator skin shoes or whatever he was wearing. But he was always so cool to us and always so nice. And the one thing that hit home with me is – One of our buddies is from, he played in Weyburn, Saskatchewan, where Barry played junior at. And this kid named Colton Sanderson, I'll give him a shout out. He's like my best friend. He wasn't playing at the time. He ended up winning a national championship. He was a big part of that team. But for 3 years, he basically was scratched every single game. And Barry took the time that year in Philadelphia to talk to him and have a conversation for probably 15, 20 minutes just about Sask, about their coach they both played for, and a guy named Dwight McMillan. So I just thought that was so cool how Barry always took time for the guys. Oh, he was so nice. He was really actually intrigued and interested to hear your background. And whenever we go in there, like the you guys would grab like four or five players just to kind of chop it up, right, a little bit of background knowledge. He was always so cool. You were too, but it was just so cool to from a legend of the game and that you know we all watched and, you know, coach a team to a final. It was so cool just to be, you know, in his presence because he really did uplift a room. So just touch on Barry a little bit and you know, let us know how he's doing because I miss seeing that guy, man. It's and I'm sure as a good friend of, you know, yours, it's it stings a little bit.
Oh yeah, I mean, it probably, you know, certainly on the one hand, if I pick five of my most treasured relationships in my years at ESPN, he's certainly one of them. Just a man's man, so much charisma, like you said. You know, coaching Wayne Gretzky, reaching the final, and then going to ESPN, and really, again, during those years of ESPN when you had to watch television and Barry was on SportsCenter besides the hockey specialty shows. And, yeah, so I started doing the Frozen Four in 2013 was my first one in Pittsburgh.
Okay.
And like you said, we'll get there early, and then we'll bring four or five players for each team the day before the semifinal games. And just, yeah, especially those – it didn't so much happen the last 4 or 5 years because – but for your era, those first, yeah, when Barry walked in, it was a big deal. Like for them to see Barry Melrose and to hear him and see him and talk to him, that was huge. And then it's funny, the last couple of years, these kids don't quite, again, they don't watch SportsCenter as much. They don't watch TV as much.
Yeah.
So, you know, Barry didn't have that same impact as he did with your era. You know, it's just funny how TV has gone that way. But no, it was every time we go out to dinner and when we walk in, everybody would turn and look as we walk across the room to our table at Barry as he walked to the table, whether it was men, women, whoever. Like you said, always had a jacket on, always on time. But yeah, diagnosed with Parkinson's a couple of years ago, and it was just heartbreaking. Finally, it reached the point where he had to come public with it. I'm glad he did. I know he would get an outpouring of sympathy and empathy like he didn't imagine. I knew it. And it was unbelievable when I tweeted out that video of kind of Barry's career and what's next. It got a million views so quickly. And again, I was not surprised. And so, you know, he sounds pretty good. I talked to him a couple of weeks ago. He sounds pretty good, but it's, you know, it stinks for a guy who had such amazing wit, razor sharp wit, locker room wit. As you guys know, that's where you build a wit, is in that locker room. It's just a great training ground for your mind to come up with things and hold your own and keep up. And so he had that locker room, you know, plus one handicap wit, you know, that that he has, and us hackers out here thinking that we're sharp and witty, not being in the NHL locker room here in the best of the best, is like, well, see, you better pick it up. So he made us all better. So yeah, I love the guy to death. I'm kind of like an older brother I didn't have, you know, and just love being 100%. Treated everybody with gold, took every picture, signed every autograph. First we signed autographs when I started ESPN, and then he took pictures. And so he never said no to anybody. He's a great role model that way on how to treat, like you said, anybody, the janitor or the owner, he's comfortable with either person in a room.
Yeah, he's an unbelievable guy. And like Jordo was saying, us going to the Frozen Four, that was kind of like, you know, you knew you were in the big show, you know, when you got you and Barry there, you know, interviewing you, and it was like, let's go, like, we get to talk to Bucci and Melrose, you know, we're all fired up. But on the college subject, you know, Bucci, I wanted to thank you and Barry, obviously, for growing the game of college hockey. It feels like, you know, before that, there was really no big person in media talking about college hockey, supporting it, you know, trying to grow the game. And I think, you know, to me, you're kind of the first guy to ever do that. And, you know, I think I owe you a big thank you because I'm a big college hockey guy. And you didn't have to do that. No one else is doing it. You know, it's a small, you know, the amount of people that are paying attention to it isn't that much. But you give it your time and grow the game. So I wanted to thank you for that. But I do have to get your thoughts on this season. Which teams are we looking to expect to have in the Frozen Four this year? Obviously, it's the first half. Things can change, but...
Yep. Well, I've loved covering the sport, first of all. And like you said, when I was named the voice of the Frozen Four in 2012, I felt like I want to give this sport the proper respect it deserves. So many times guys would show up, only say three names on each team. They didn't take the time to learn the lines. They didn't watch during the regular season. And, you know, Barry was a little guilty of that, but that's because he had to watch NHL every night. So obviously Barry took a lot of the flack for not knowing the college game inside and out, but you know, I would keep him prepped. I'd help produce him. But the reason why we brought him there, because what you just said, he made a big show, you know, and that's in, and he gave it a big oomph to that and ended up doing 20 of them, you know? So, but yeah, I've loved doing it. And that came along when Twitter came along. When I got on Twitter and kind of got good at Twitter, that's when I was named the Frozen Four voice. I'm thinking, okay, what can I do? First of all, to pay attention. That's why I started with the rankings. I started the rankings because that made me pay attention every week. And then the Bucci Overtime Challenge blew up like I never thought it would blow up. I'm selling $20,000 worth of t-shirts a month that first year. Just for people sure. sending me money in the mail.
Yeah.
You know, because I didn't have a website yet. It's just so bizarre looking back how that happened. It was one of the most amazing, unbelievable, stupid things. So then I start college hockey. Like, oh, let me start. I'll try that. And that takes off. And I still sell more college hockey gear now than I actually do Bucci Overtime gear now. But so I was like Dick Vitale, right? I was the guy waving the national, like you said, there was never a national guy waving the pom poms.
Yeah.
And that first job in Providence, I went to the 1996 Frozen Four, first one I'd ever gone to. Again, I grew up in Pittsburgh. There's no college hockey out there. I come east. I get a job in Cape Cod. No college hockey down there. I get to Providence. I go to this Frozen Four. Yeah, I'll go cover it. I love hockey. I've known hockey since I was a kid. My dad grew up in Boston. He played. And so I go, oh, my God, this is unbelievable. The Thursday doubleheader, all these bands, yeah. All these people wearing sweaters from schools who aren't even there. I was like, wow, this was unbelievable. It was like a punk rock organic thing. That those are the things I like. I like passionate people. I like small audiences who are really into something as opposed to an all-star game or Super Bowl crowd. A bunch of people just kind of there for the party, right? I like small groups who are really into something. That's more my jam. And that's what, yeah, in college hockey, I've seen it take so many twists and turns. You know, when I start doing it, Quinnipiac wins their first. Union wins their first. Like everybody, you know, Providence wins their first. Then UMass would win their first. But now it's interesting, whether it's NIL or whatever it is, now the Blue Bloods are back, right? And you look at the top of the heap, it's BU, it's BC, it's North Dakota, it's Wisconsin, Minnesota's hanging around, Michigan's hanging around, Michigan sure. State's back, Maine's yeah. back. It's like, yeah. So this is exciting. And you still have Quinnipiac. They win their first natty last year. They're still right there. They're a one seed. They're going to be – they might lose one more game this year. Look, you've seen their ECAC schedule. They yeah. might win out. They're going to be 30-4, you know. And yeah. so, but they're still good. You know, they're good. Not like they're – yeah, they play. Yeah, obviously their schedule isn't the same as a Big Ten or an NCHC, but they're still good. Obviously, three national championship games since I started covering it in 2013. So, but yeah, I it's going to be like you said, it's hard to say, but I always love to have three big schools and one Cinderella. So like this year in St. Paul, Minnesota, you know, they have, you know, North Dakota, Minnesota, BC or BU, and then maybe one school out of nowhere that kind of surprises, you know. Is always kind of my recipe for what I want at a Frozen Four. But no, it is awesome. I think it's pretty even across the board. No one really stands out. So it's going to be fun to watch here next couple of months and see how the Hobie takes shape, who starts to, you know, to keep yeah. ascending and going up. And then you start seeing the stats. Okay, this guy's a Hobie guy. And so I'm looking forward to college hockey. He's healthy. It's strong. It's growing. There's going to be more teams. It's a revenue producer. Which is big for schools. Arizona State, it was good to see their coach tweet out, say, no, we make money. Penn State makes money. You know, there's only yeah, two sports.
That's huge. You
know, when Penn State started, two sports made money, football and hockey. I think basketball's caught up now because the Big Ten money is ridiculous. So all those schools are. Uh-huh. But in terms of the actual sport team making money, you know, hockey teams can make money for schools.
Yeah, that's huge.
Bucci, speaking of the Frozen Four, brother, that game in Philly that you called in 2014 when we lost in the dying seconds to our arch nemesis, Minnesota, that still stings, yeah. brother. Right on the river,
of course
too.
It does.
Just a muffin. Like I wake up in the middle of the night and I still think, I think we outplayed him that game. I mean, you were sitting up top. Not that it fucking matters, but, man, I thought for a team,
no, I know.
North Dakota team, man, that one still stings, but It's the way of the game. Don't realize,
I've lost games in high school that still hurt. So I know what you mean. Yeah. It never goes away. Yeah.
Oh, especially just losing to those guys. It's
and then of course Josh Despair going +7 in the final was so cool, you know. And
that was
really neat. So yeah, I love the Frozen Four. Had great memories there. I got my first overtime winner last year. I was so excited when it went to overtime because that was my first one that I got a national championship call. And luckily I was right on it, right off the face off. I wasn't doing something else, blah, blah, blah. Set it up and then bam, it happens. And so that was really exciting. And like I said, this year I think we're going to have an awesome Frozen Four in St. Paul.
For sure. A great building too in the XL Center over in St.
Paul. Yes, it is.
Bucci, NHL Talk, the Frozen Frenzy, brother. I want to start at the top of that. Whose idea was this? How did it come along? I mean, the NHL needed some sort of mock to an NFL red zone. We finally got it. I thought that was awesome. Whose idea was this? Was this kind of a collective effort at ESPN? And when are we going to see the next one? Because I mean, I was glued to the TV from 4 Mountain to about midnight. It was awesome to see you doing up and back studio to studio. Like, you got to have a decent cardio too, because you're going, you know,
not really. I'm not really a cardio guy. No, I'm not really. People think I am. But you look like a runner. I go, yeah, I look like it, but I'm not. It's the best thing. Right. I don't have to run to look like one. But I do not like to run. But that was, I think, one of our executives. You know, we had to push hard for the NHL to get staggered start times. Each of their owners likes their own start time, you know, for their own, their season ticket base or for their benefit. But we finally got the NHL to do that. And I had low expectations. I was a little afraid going in that, man, people were really excited about this because the buildup was like, this is going to be awesome. I'm like, it's not like the red zone. Like, when you get to the red zone, there's a winner or loser. Someone's either going to kick a field goal, score a touchdown, turnover, get stopped, go for it in fourth down. But something's going to happen. Either the defense is going to win or the offense is going to win. So I was afraid we'd go to a game and nothing would happen. But, man, early on, that's great about when you're in television, you know when you're doing good TV. You know when it sucks. You know when it's blah. You know when it's painful. Like, I'm doing the I'm one of the co-hosts on the players draft at the All-Star game in Toronto. We just added that. I think me and David Amber, I think, are doing it. I'm just thinking, boy, that might be uncomfortable. You know, we'll see are the players into it as they drafting players. Is it going to be funny? Are they going to be quiet and reserved like they usually are? So I'm a little worried about that. And that's how I was for the Frozen Frenzy.
Right. What are they going to do?
It was awesome.
Sorry to butt in there. Yeah, it was awesome. Sorry to cut you off there, but what are they going to do in terms of that NHL All-Star Game draft? Are they going to go full Phil Kessel mode again and give them the old life-size Kia if someone goes last overall?
Once you're down to four, you pull them out of a hat, I guess. So they're going to avoid the
Super Bowl this time.
Other than that, I haven't seen a script yet. They just decided to do it a week ago. It's like, hey, can you come in a day early? I go, I'll be golfing in Arizona. I'll need to take a red eye. So I found one. So I'll take a red eye after Wednesday and get there early Thursday and then take a nap and go do the show Thursday night. But yeah, I was worried that the Frozen Frenzy wouldn't pay off. But man, early on, I could tell this is great TV. I mean, we were there for 6 hours. It felt like 20 minutes. When when you're doing TV and it goes fast, or really any media, that's when it's good. That's when the pacing's good. There's enough interest. You're not ever sleeping. You're engaged. So it was good. I knew right away it was going good. We had the superstar scoring goals. We had great finishes. We had the staggered times, which kept the action flowing. So I was and then since then, when I go to rinks and do games, not once since that's happened has not at least one person not said, man, that Frozen Frenzy was amazing. Like, this was the best PR thing for ESPN. But ESPN is not used to hearing people say nice things about it. So it was great to hear compliments from people saying that was awesome. So, yeah, I would think we would do it again. I would think you would need at least 10 games. You don't need all 15, but you definitely need, I think, 10, 11, or 12. You need some staggered times from the league. They got to do it. It's so frustrating when we see 7:30 games, you get the NHL package on ESPN Plus. Yeah. They're all in between periods at the same time. Then you go you go somewhere else, and you might not come back again. I mean, I will, but some people might not. So why not go 7:30, 7:34, 7:38? It only has to be 3-4 minutes. That's all you got to do, you know?
Yeah, to catch some of those games just like right at period where you can have 5 or 6 minutes to watch it. But you and Weeksy killed that, Bucci. Hopefully it's going to be coming back maybe on, sometime after the new year. Because that was awesome. I think people really enjoyed that.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask you, I wanted to ask you, because you're always like a innovative, creative mind. You always have these ideas in your head. And
go on.
I guess I wanted to ask, if the NHL expanded to one city, and I know you're a big advocate for expansion, like, where's the first city you would like to see the NHL go in terms of if they're adding a team in 2, 3, 4 years here?
Yeah, I'm not sure if there's one city. You know, certainly as the league, you know, the league always talks about, you know, diversity and trying to get more people to play, which is always good. You know, certainly that's where I think Atlanta, if it's in the right place, like in Arizona, if it's near Scottsdale, and then right. Houston, mm-hmm. those are two cities. And plus those are two big TV markets. So there's top 10 TV markets in diverse cities in the South still. So you're kind of growing the map as well. That kind of checks a lot of boxes for the NHL in terms of a big TV market. So if that team makes the finals, you should get a lot of viewers because that city's big, right? That's why the NHL wants big cities in the finals, because still hockey's still a local sport. And so you want a big mm-hmm. city because you're going to get most of that city watching. And then you always get a national number two. So that's why Houston and Atlanta, one could be in the West, one could be in the East. You know, you give Dallas maybe a little rivalry, a little in-state rivalry. But certainly Kansas City would be cool. You know, I mean, they have an arena ready to go. Obviously, if you go to Quebec, you know you're going to get sold out. And you're probably going to make a lot of revenue because you can charge a lot of money because you're going to sell out. So that's that's cool. But, you know, I'd rather have more teams in America. We only have have 20 – how many teams in Canada? Seven?
Yes, what is it?
Seven, right? Vancouver, Edmonton, yeah. Winnipeg, Ottawa. Yeah, Ottawa, Toronto, and Montreal. Yeah, so there's only 25 USA teams, right? So right. every other sport has over 30 teams all in the U.S. There's the Raptors, there's one, and the Blue Jays are the only non-USA teams. Football is all U.S. So that's when people say, yeah, if they have the same amount of teams, why would you expand? Well, because we only have 25 teams in the U.S. So we can go to five more cities in the U.S.
Salt Lake
Kansas City, Houston, Salt Lake City's awesome. That's a natural one. They're definitely going there. The owner, they love the owner. They have the Olympics coming up. They've got a new venue. It's beautiful. Great airport, too, by the way. Top 10 airport. I'm big on airports.
Yeah.
So it's a great airport as well. Yeah. Big airport guy.
I like
I like that. I think Salt Lake
City. How about you? Is there a city that you feel they should be in?
No, I think Salt Lake City. I don't know if you could do San Diego. I mean, I played there in the American Hockey League, aka the Jungle. They always get great fans there. Now, can you replicate that at a National Hockey League level where fans are willing to pay a ticket price probably 2 to 4 times what they're paying for the AHL? That's another team in California with Anaheim closed. I don't know if that makes sense, but it is a great city. I think Salt Lake City is a no-brainer. I think, like you said, Houston, Atlanta, those would be good ads.
I would like to see middle of the country. You know, I think middle of the country. Yeah. We're seeing college hockey starting to grow there, right?
Right.
Because I mean, the U.S. You know, Omaha's a cool little city. You know, it might be too small for NHL, but you know, they have a hockey history. Sioux Falls, you know, these places in Kansas, like I said, Kansas City to get in St. Louis. Obviously, they produced NHL players. In you know, you see the kids who grew up and play there. So. I think middle America has been kind of – that's why Columbus was a nice ad, I think, and Nashville. You know, the middle part of the country we kind of ignored. It's like all on the coast, you know. And so to add those – so I think a Kansas City could work, and any kind of a growing city. We'll have to see how the demographics in the country go.
Absolutely. Bucci, another question I wanted to ask just to pick your brain. How do we fix the NHL OT? In terms of getting or nixing the shootout, do you go to a 10-minute 3-on-3? Is there a way maybe you expand it to like roller hockey rules where there's no offside, or maybe when you go over the red line, that is considered onside and you can play from, you know, the extended zone from the red line in? Because a lot of the times when I'm watching 3-on-3 hockey, not every game, but it seems like it's just jumbled up and you're just kind of running like the Harlem Globetrotters half-court offense where it's just like guys cycling the puck, waiting to do something, and it kind of gets really stagnant. And then the only real chance you get is if someone misses a net or guys get tired. So what are your thoughts on how to really spice up OT and basically get rid of the shootout? Because I think the shootout was cool post lockout when it came in. You know, it was a fun, exciting thing where you could watch Patty Kane slow it down to basically slow motion, dust off the mitts and go forehand, backhand and have a goalie in the corner. But like, to me, this shootout right now is just not as exciting as it used to be.
Yeah, I agree. It's definitely got a little passe. I don't think it's that important of an issue over time to change it. Regulation wins are still the most important thing. So that's good. I think you could try to at least add 2 minutes at first, you know, want to add 2 minutes. I think the Players Association would agree to 2 minutes and then see if that lowers the number of shootouts next year, right? So let's go to 7 starting next year and then see if that lowers the number of game, you know, shootouts. The Toronto-Boston overtime was phenomenal the other night.
Yeah.
And but you're right, that's rare, but it did happen. Yep. And so maybe we just got to live with a little bit of sometimes that tactical soccer-looking territorial overtime, which in some ways can have a little strategy around it. Okay, I can accept this. If you can learn maybe to like that when it happens that way. And then when it gets frenetic, which it does occasionally, then that becomes like, oh, this is awesome. It's like an Easter egg. It's a surprise. So, you know, but yeah, I do think we should first start with expanding overtime by a couple of minutes. Let's try 7. Maybe that'll be enough. Maybe that would have produced 20% more overtime winners instead of a shootout. Like you said, the fewer shootouts, the better for sure. It's gotten a little passy. Occasionally, there's a really – and, again, when someone wins and they clinch it, it's still exciting, right? The guy – when the goalie makes a save, he's pumped. Or whether the guy in the bottom of the inning scores to win, they're pumped. So – and especially at home or even on the road. Road wins are great, too. I love road crowd noise. I talked about that. You guys tweeted that cool North Dakota crowd in Denver, and I love road crowd noise. So, yeah, that's the best. So, yeah, I don't think it's – so basically to answer your question, I don't think it's that big of an issue to get too worried about. But I think if we try to get to 7 minutes and 7.5 and see if we can eliminate some shootouts to make them a little more rare. But in terms of the changing the rules to pond hockey and stuff, I mean, these points are valuable. So you do have to try to, I think, stay within the rules as much as you can of real hockey to get the right teams in the playoffs, right? Who play by the rules that you're going to have in the playoffs. So yeah, it's tough. Like, it is entertaining.
Even going, how do you feel about when a team takes a penalty in OT? I was talking to my brother about this the other night. Like, instead of going to 4-on-3, what if you went to 3-on-2? Is that too, you know?
I would. Non-traditional. I'd be okay with that. Yeah, I hate.
Be okay with that.
I hate 4-on-3 during regulation. Even
right.
It's like you. It just. I don't know what about it. It's just. It makes it worse almost. I don't know what it is. But yeah, I'd love to go 3-on-2, I'd make the penalties 1 minute, like in youth hockey, like you know they're 1 minute long. They shouldn't be 2 minutes in overtime. Like if you get a penalty halfway through overtime, it's 100% of the rest of the game. That seems silly to me. Make the penalties 60 seconds. Then you might have more urgency on a 4-on-3, 3-on-2, or whatever. Plus the guy's coming out of the box, so that could be really exciting. Yeah. So I think if you Because people don't realize they want – people scream for penalties. You guys know the best games are 5-on-5 because that's up and down. As soon as you call a penalty, it becomes stagnant. People – especially when you watch the Penguin power play. Then it's really stagnant. I mean, that's boring, you know. So we want 5-on-5 aggressive hockey. So, yeah, I think in overtime, make the penalties a minute. You'll have more people popping on the ice. I'm all for 3-on-2. That would be fun. And you'd have more winners that way. You'd make them, you know, the penalties would be more of a penalty. Again, just 60 seconds. You got 60 seconds, a couple clears, and you'll kill it. But that would be fun, 3-on-2, just to see. Because imagine those two defenders would be, like, exhausted, breaking their ankles, scrambling around, chasing after the one-timers on the side. So it would be fun. Imagine anything. Try anything is always my rule change. Because then if it doesn't work, change it back. It's just sports.
Yeah, for sure. It's easy.
I think that 3-on-2 would be so funny because you'd be sending over a guy like Chris Tanev, for example, on Calgary, and he's going to be like blocking everything with his face. Like that guy's insane. You know, like he'd be wearing rubber. Like I think it would
let him put on a fishbowl on 3-on-2. Yeah. Players can
should
wear
have the 3-on-2 bucket they can wear.
3-on-2 bucket. Here's the 3-on-2 bucket because you're going to be.
He'd have the chicken parm welding shield on that you retweeted there the other day.
That made me laugh out loud. The welding shield.
That's good.
But yeah, I think we should start pushing that on Twitter. The 3-on-2 bucket.
Yeah. Chicken parm had that visor down to his chin. I mean, safety first, like he said. And who am I to chirp a guy that played about 1,400 games? But I had a good laugh looking at Chicky Parm with the Cooper bucket on,
the welding shield down to his laces.
Yes. Well,
that's like Heatley. He had the Camaro windshield on back then.
Yeah.
learned it from Ferraro in Atlanta. Like Ray probably said, get a bigger shield, dude.
Yeah, I mean, you're playing hockey at the end of the day, but Booch, last just hypothetical question I wanted to ask you, because again, I just think you're such an interesting cat. Where can we expand these outdoor games to? I thought that game, just in terms of when it was at, where was it? Lake Tahoe.
Yeah.
That was unbelievable. Like a setting where you can bring it to like Lake Louise or somewhere like out rural in nature and like where hockey is at its roots. I think that would be so much cooler than going into some of these stadiums. Now, these stadiums are still cool. I think the Winter Classic, they do a good job with, but just looking at that game on TV at Lake Tahoe with the mountains and the lake backed up to it and David Pastrnak going bass shades on and warm-ups. Like,
That's great, but they lost money. You know, this is a big revenue producer. That's why they're in football stadiums.
Right.
And so it's so a lot of money they make.
Is there any way you could do like a pay-per-view game like that or where people wouldn't buy it or, you know what I mean, where you could charge money to watch the game? Because I just thought
– I mean, obviously, get maybe big sponsorships, really creative temporary seating to get – again, you're only going to get 5,000 people on a site like that.
5,000 people in there.
You're not going to get 70,000 there unless you charge them 10 grand a ticket, you know, then you can make up for it. But, that's why, really, the revenue. Obviously, those are expensive events to put on. And if you can't get the ticket revenue from 60,000 people, you know, that's a big one. So this year, you know, Giant Stadium is going to be an interesting one there, MetLife. They have those two games. Mm-hmm. But, again, it's still a football stadium. But the overhead shot, it'll be good for TV. I went to one – I've gone to a couple Winter Classics now. One in Pittsburgh, and I went to the Fenway Park one a couple years ago. It was a charity item, go to a game with Bucci. So, my first one I went to, I felt like this is enough. It's like it's fun walking in, and it's fun, but you can't hear the game. If the sounds of hockey are hard to hear. But what they did in Boston, which is really cool, they put microphones on the ice so the people in the park could hear the sticks and the blades. That was a great idea, and that was really. And you could also hear the occasional F bomb. They didn't cut the mic off, and that was really cool. So it was it really added the experience. I really applaud the NHL for thinking of that and doing that. And but Fenway Park was cool, but yeah, Lake Tahoe was really a cool thing. If they could somehow figure out a way to get the revenue enough at least to break even or maybe lose a little bit, like you said, it's still once in a while to bring to a place like that might be worth it because it's memorable, right? That's the one you remember.
Oh,
and that's what you want. Yeah, so that game has value that you remember that.
For sure. That game and then the game at Wrigley Field, Detroit. For Chicago when Bab sat Chelly and he had his kids bringing him beers. I mean, those are the two games that stick up because that was all time. Unbelievable. Chelly having beers on the bench. Are you kidding me? In a National Hockey League game? Good. Talk about a legend. I mean,
that guy, not only that guy knows good everybody.
He knows everybody. That is
He couldn't go to work one day last year at ESPN because he went to Michael Jordan's 60th birthday party. There's like 50 people there, and Chelly's one of them. You know, Oprah Winfrey and Chelly hanging out
at the table. Yeah, I was going to say having cottage mustard and gorgonzola.
Yeah, with Oprah Chelly Winfrey. Like,
is that tan? Is that stock, or is that is he in the bed a couple
Greek,
times?
He's Greek, man.
A week?
He is Greek.
Really? And that's guy stock, is, even that in the guy, winter.
Yeah, and I know you guys are sauna. You guys are sauna fans of the sauna.
Oh, yeah.
Chelly's a sauna fanatic. Every city he goes to, he finds a sauna and he's there. He's in, and he does it. So he got a routine, and yeah, he's out. He surfs. Got a house in Malibu. So that tan, he's in. You know, go to the Bahamas with Messier. You know, so yeah, he's always. He got that Greek skin, baby. He got 5 minutes of sun. He's got a full base.
Yeah. Ooh, that's like on that UHL or IHL video. You remember that where that guy was chirping and Chelly was playing it when like during the lockout? And he's like, Jesus, Chelly, let's get back from fucking Costa Rica, Mexico. Yeah. He's like, he's like, fuck, let the kids play, eh?
Yeah, let the kids play. Hey, Bucci, you got to, when you're in Chicago next time, I don't know if you've been there, but the bathhouse that he always hits is off of Division Street, that Russian sauna. Have you been there? The Red Square? Off of Division Street in Chicago. You got to pop in there. It's like an old school place. It's got like the hottest Russian sauna I've ever been in. The cold pub is insane, but that's Chelly's spot. That's always been his go-to spot. So anytime I'm in Chicago,
games in Chicago this year, unfortunately. I got my schedule for the rest of the year, so I'm not going to get to Chicago, unfortunately.
Damn. You know, next time you're there, you're going to have to pop in. But
I will. I'll have to check it out.
Gucci. I'm going boots on the ground tonight at the iconic Mullet Arena, the spectacle over there in Tempe. Ovi's in town. You've been tweeting about
this forever. I did the first NHL game there.
Yeah, that's right.
That'll be on my little resume. First one.
Ovi, a little down this year in terms of scoring. You're a guy that's been tweeting about it for, fuck, I don't know, the last decade. He's going to break Waino's record.
2009, 2008, 2008, still... I wrote about it.
Okay. Oh. Is he still going to get this done?
Oh, yeah, he'll get it done. He scores them in bunches. You know, he'll get 10 in a week. You know how Obi rolls. He's definitely eased his way into this season. He has not put out a max effort yet. Maybe it's the new coach trying to feel his way with the new coach. And they got off to a surprising start. I didn't think they'd be this good. But Spencer Carberry is a very good coach. And he's got them going a little bit. But he'll get them in bunches. You know, he'll get two. Then he'll get a Hattie. And then, like, you know, he'll get 7-8 in a week. And suddenly he'll be up at 12, 13 near the leaders. But, yeah, it's a very slow start. A little unlucky. He's getting shots. He's getting opportunities. But he needs to pick it up a little bit. And I'm not sure what's going on because he does look like the same guy. Whether he's pacing himself for the long haul, trying to figure out as he ages. But, no, he'll get it done either late next year. They've got to pick up the pace here soon. Or it'll be early the following year. So, and I hope I'm doing the game. But, yeah, he'll get it done for sure. And he's built to play hockey. And flap shots don't age. People score goals well into their late 30s. Esposito did it. Brett Hull did it. Brendan Shanahan did it. I went back. That's when I made that. Back in 2008, I kind of went in the future until he was 40 years old, predicting his goals schedule each year. And part of it was historical precedence. Like when he was 37, I had him scoring like 39 goals because Esposito did it one time and Hull did it one time. And so there was precedence. So, yeah, as long as he'll get it done, like I said, either late next year or early the year after that.
Beautiful.
I hope so. Got to sign.
It'll be great for hockey. Right, I mean, it's the one record in sports that people will be excited about. NFL doesn't care about records. When LeBron broke 100%. The point record, nobody really cared. You know, people don't care about records in basketball. But baseball and hockey, people really love records. And I think this is the last great one to be had. And it's going to be a big moment because obviously Wayne will be a part of it. And Wayne is such a great ambassador. It's going to be great for the sport when he does it. It's going to be a big deal.
100%.
For sure.
Bucci, last little bit from my end. I'm making my TV debut this weekend up at North Dakota as a part of Midco Sportsnet. I'm going to be a panel analyst. Any advice from a veteran, you know, going into this weekend, low and slow? What are we doing? You know, I got to do my research. Obviously, it's Colorado College visiting the North Dakota Fighting Sioux. So any advice from a veteran getting his reps here as a rookie?
Yeah. I mean, obviously you're prepared. You watch the games, you know, North Dakota hockey, and that's the most important team people want to hear about, but you know, don't get caught up too much in the numbers. Talk from the heart. It's a game of passion. That's why Barry connected with the viewers so well. He was about, and that's why I think analytics and too many numbers are ruining the sports fan experience and the viewer experience, because it takes out the passion and brings in the head. We're trying to get out of our heads. We're all in our heads too much. You want to live in the heart and the gut. And that's where life is meant to be lived. And so that's where life is meant to be broadcasted. So you talk about effort. Certainly you talk about a system or a tactic once in a while. And this is why this team is good. And this is why, you know, but you really come back to the heart and the passion of the game. And it does come about winning battles, and it does come about, you know, and but you know, look good. It's a visual medium. Have a good suit. Wear something loud. Make a statement. Yep. You know, get a loud blazer, get a tie, open the collar up. I don't know, bring it down a couple. Chest toupee, medallion. Yeah. Do something big. Wear those glasses. Just something that stands out. It is TV. It's a TV show. It's the That's actually took me a while to realize that ESPN. I always look at myself as a sportscaster. And then getting ESPN, being owned by Disney, ABC, you realize we're in the entertainment business as much as Taylor Swift is. And so that's what we're here to entertain. Get people to watch and listen and engage. Still know what you're talking about. Know the rules. Know the game. You have to watch all the games. That's what any analyst, you can't not. You know who watches the games and who doesn't by who. Yeah. Right. You know the analysts are, whether it's a game analyst or a studio analyst. But yeah, studio is about having something to say right off the bat. Speaking headlines. You know, a game you have time to kind of talk and to converse. But for you, when they go to you, you got to bring it right away. That first sentence. Bring it the first sentence and have something to say. Speak in headlines. Be ready to have something to say. So think about what you're going to say, what message you want to set across, and then get it out. So that's it. That's how you prepare, is speaking in big headlines, being bold and talking bold and looking bold. That's the secret sauce.
Beautiful.
I love it. You're going
to
nail it, Jordan.
It helps to be a little drunk. You know, it's all a little better when we're drinking a little bit.
Right.
100%.
A little half-cocked. Well,
which is what I need right now at the hotel bar.
Right. My secret sauce is two Irish coffees before anything I do because it puts me right on the screws. You know, I got the peak state of the caffeine, but I also have the Jameson whiskey and the Baileys, now I'm in flow state, brother. And now I'm snapping up your mind, right? Tape. Yes. I'm like Cam McCarr out there. Your mind is open. I compare it to like Jason Williams, a.k.a. White Chocolate, you know, on the hardwood. Yes. I can just see everything. I got eyes behind my back, and I'm just making all the plays. So, Bucci, no, you're a beauty.
Perfect.
Thank you for coming on our show. And, brother, if you need an extra for one of these This Is Sports Center commercials, give me a buzz. I'll call my wig guy. I got a fur guy already. And, you know, I'll throw the chinchilla on, and we'll make it happen. So, I appreciate you stopping in, man.
Thank you, boys. You're beauties, and thanks for having me. It's an honor and a privilege.
Yep, we'll have to do it again. Bucci. Folks, anytime. That was John Buccigross from ESPN. Runs a play-by-play for ESPN Hockey, SportsCenter anchor, friend of the show now, legend. So, Bucci, thanks again. A guy that me and Gage ended up, we watched growing up. So, low and slow, baby. Woo!
Peace.